we are live on broadcast. I am Debbie here with you on something. Saturday night.
So you can see the levels.
Saturday night is all right for fighting. Get a little action in. Get about as oiled as a diesel train. Come and set the dance alight. Because Saturday night's the night I like. Saturday night's all right, all right, all right. I don't sing that well, do I? I used to play this when I would open my show on Saturday night. We're expecting Chris Nelson. He said he's going to call in. I don't know what he's doing. I don't know if he's at work or what, but he asked me to do a show. Pumpkin Face and I usually do a show on Saturday night where we sing stupid songs and we take requests from the audience and we have to sing what you tell us to sing. The last one that we did last Saturday was hysterical because they were making me sing boy songs and they were making him sing girl songs and it was really funny. Victor took over for me last night. I was so tired I passed out. And then I heard that a couple of other people did a couple of shows. I'm sorry, what?
There's been very many people asking for requesting me again.
You already have a fan club. Yeah, you do. I wonder how this guy would sound. Oh, this is the original. What is that noise? It's Boo Boo snoring. All right, I am here, though.
God.
Can you hear snoring? Did Benny and the Jets, and she sang the song. She sang the lyrics all wrong on that movie. What was that movie? Let me think. That movie was 27 Dresses. When she goes, Benny, she sang them all fucked up and stuff. Let me see if I can find that song. God, Boo-Boo, you're snoring so loud. 27 Dresses, Benny and the Jets. Oh, it's funny. Here we go. The Benny and the Jets, where she sings it all wrong. It's really funny. And some fucknose record. Why would somebody put a video on YouTube where they record their freaking television? What an idiot.
Great song.
Song.
Hey, kids, shake, lose a limb off. Turn the one and sing, gonna make a feather.
That's exactly the words. Sorry, lyric police, what are the words?
You're gonna hairy hands and music so the walrus sounds.
Walrus sounds?
She takes pennies and longer in a cement jet. Ooh, but she's so blazed down.
Benny and Jess.
Oh, and the wind and the waterfall. Oh, baby, she's a replicator. She's got electric boots.
Boots?
Oh, her shoes.
Benny and the Jets.
Victor's so polite. He knows I only watch chick flicks half the time. I tried to watch a movie the other night by myself that Sonny had told me about and somebody else had told me about. So I sit down at Netflix. Thank you, Mad Dog 61, for your Netflix sign-in. And I logged in and I thought, okay, I'm going to really, really sit here and try to watch it, because Sonny and the One Angry Jew told me that it was like the best movie in the whole world. You know, it was just like, oh my God. It was called No Country for Old Men. Okay? Now, while there is definitely a scene in there, why can't I hear myself? Oh, Victor was on the mic. That's right. There I am. While there is a scene in there, I'll give you that much. There is an amazing scene where it's supposed to be. Actually, I talked to this guy named Tyler today, a friend of mine that I've known, gosh, I don't even know how long, maybe forever. And I was talking about the movie, and he said that when he was in college, that they were to, he was in, I don't know what he was in, speech or drama or something, and they had to pick out one scene in a movie that was very, very high. I had to ask Tyler what he said. High in tension. You know what I'm saying? Tension to where you don't know what's going to happen. And he said that he did the scene from Tombstone where Johnny Ringo and Doc Holliday exchange. And they speak Latin. You know, he says, in vino veritae, and he says, age coragis, and he says, you know, in wine there's truth, and he says, and then he comes back and says, yeah, you're going to see your own funeral. And he did that one. He didn't do it, but I don't know how he was talking about, but anyway. And he said that he remembered a friend of his, one of his roommates or something like that, that did the scene from No Country for Old Men, or Old Men for No Country. I think it's No Country for Old Men. And it's amazing that it is actually shot on location in Texas. I mean, there's some really nasty places, and not nasty, but there's some barren places in Texas. Like if you go out there by Palo Duro Canyon, around Olney and Loving and Jean, there's some really one horse towns. I mean, some really scary one horse towns. And it was actually where a lot of this stuff took place. And he was telling me that Johnny Ringgold was actually from there. And I was like, I don't know if that's true or not. Because, see, the reason I love the Old West is because my grandfather in West Texas, he owned a company. I can tell you now, you know, you can't dox him. He owned JT's, it was called J&T Cotton Gin Repair Corporation or whatever. And he owned it forever. And he was he was a capitalist. My grandfather was a true capitalist. And what I mean by that is he was from the northeastern part of Texas, my family. And when cotton gins, this is way back in, I think the 40s or something like that, or the 50s, I don't remember. I mean, of course, I don't remember, but anyway, he migrated west and settled in a town out there up on the Cap Rock called Plainview, right outside of Lubbock, and he bought just acres and acres and acres of land off of Alton Route. Alton Route is off of 84. 84 runs between Amarillo, Texas, and Lubbock. It's just a barren, flat highway. It's got nothing but cotton gins. Grain elevators are all over it. And anyway, the bottom line is he, I'm sorry, Fufu is snoring. He capitalized on the fact that there was all of these people were putting up all of these cotton gins. That's Fufu snoring. And nobody had a cotton gin servicing company, because cotton gins back there, and they worked off what was called ribs. And what these ribs were amazingly sharp, curved pieces of, I guess, steel or wrought iron. I don't know what they were. And he welded them constantly. and he would sharpen them, and they would put the cotton up in the top of the elevator, which was way up on top, and then it would go around and around, and it would get all of the yucky stuff out of it by going through these real sharp things. And then he had cotton, fields and fields and fields of cotton. And the neatest thing about him was he would do this thing called irrigation. And he would tap into the ground until he found water, and then it would come up. And he would make his cotton, okay, see if you can figure this out. He would make his cotton fields, and I've walked in so many of these cotton fields. He had them off of Olton Route. The cotton fields would go in a certain formation that would be from up to down. You know what I'm talking about? It would look like downhill. And the reason why is because you wanted that water to run downhill, where the water would run downhill, but it would run the opposite way that the rows of cotton would go, because you would, as the water would come trickling down through this ditch that he would dig, he actually would dig a ditch, and the water would come downhill, and he had these big tubes that he would flip real quick. He would catch the water, and he would go flip, and he would flip it over, and it would run down that way. It would run down each one of the cotton rows. And that water, I'm here to tell you, that water that came out of the ground, it was called well water. It was the best water in the world. I kid you not, there was nothing in it. I mean, there was like no chemicals or anything, and it was fabulous. You know, we used to live so great back then. All of us did. You know, everything was so much better. Gee, Willikers, what did we do? Hi, Apocalypse. Hi, Free Stabby, whoever you are. Oh, yeah, absolutely. And so check this shit out, Apocalypse and Free Stabby. My grandfather goes out there and he opens up JT's Cotton Gin Repair Service. I still have... It's Mr. Landlord. Come on, Mr. Landlord. The beautiful, talented, brown, gorgeous, and always talkative Chris Nelson. Hello, Chris.
Hey.
How are you?
Hey, can you hear me all right?
I can hear you just fine. What's going on?
Hey, what's going on? Working the night shift again.
Oh, at the loony bin?
Yes, I love night shift. I just drank some really high-powered, concentrated coffee.
No alcohol, right?
Oh, no. No.
Yay. How many days now?
30 on Thursday, so 31.
Now,
32
look, Chris,
days.
Look, Chris, I'm just going to say this and get it over with because it's like a pink elephant in the room. If you can go 31 days without drinking, you can stop drinking. You need to realize you can't fucking drink, okay?
I can't
take Vicodin and I can't do cocaine. It's your kryptonite. Think of it as your kryptonite. Don't do it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
A lot of people don't drink. You can still have a joint, I mean, or, you know, get high every now and then or whatever, but just don't do the goddamn alcohol.
Oh, yeah, alcohol is horrible. It just destroys my life. But... So, have you heard about this Hillary Clinton stuff?
Yes, and I have something that I just figured out when I was listening to Comey talk. I call him Comey. Comey, you know what? He said, now listen to this, he said he's not going to embarrass himself this time, which means he's going to prosecute
right.
her. He's going to prosecute her. Yes, oh my
the
God.
The irony of that, she belongs in jail, and a lot of supporters supporting her. Anyway, less. Okay. The funny thing is,
Chris, your connection sucks. Chris, we can't hear you. Chris. Ground control to Major Tom. Chris, if you can hear me, call back. Chris, call back. Yeah, that's what I was going to tell y'all about. Comey, the director of the FBI, said tonight on MSNBC, I think I was watching. I'll try it again. Are you any better now?
You seriously can't hear me?
Oh, no, you just listen to the replay of the show. You went totally dead.
Okay, you can hear me now, though.
Yeah, you're a little bubbly, but we'll see if it goes works
out. Okay, yeah, it's a stupid connection, but all right. What the funny thing is where these new emails came from. Hillary Clinton has this lesbian lover named Huma Abedin. Her husband is former disgraced Congressman Anthony Weiner. Can you still hear me?
Who has a hard-on for Hillary Clinton at the moment.
Anthony Weiner, do you remember Wienergate?
Oh, yeah, I know the whole story.
Yeah, this guy, this is Hillary's, who I believe is Hillary's lesbian lover. I mean, this woman is, like, attached to Hillary, and I know Hillary's a lesbian, and I'm pretty sure that these two are together. Anyway, it's her husband, former disgraced Congressman Anthony Weiner. They seized his computer in an FBI investigation into him for possible child abuse because he likes to take naked pictures of himself and send them to all sorts of teenagers on the internet. Okay? And which I don't, you know, I mean, we've all done stupid things. I can't say that I've never taken a picture of myself and sent it to someone. Okay, so when you're drunk, you do stupid stuff, all right? But he had his little kid in the one picture. So this opened an FBI investigation into him. And they seized his computer and they found tens of thousands of new Hillary Clinton emails. And, oh, if she gets sunk because of Weiner, that will be freaking hilarious.
Well, does Weiner not like her?
I don't know what Weiner thinks about her.
I know she hates Weiner.
But, you know,
Weiner
ran for mayor of New York and all that stuff came out, all those pictures of him. I mean, he does have a nice body. He obviously works out. But, you know, he's got all these pictures of him with his junk out and in tidy whities and stuff. And he was sending them to these, like, 17, 18-year-old girls that he'd meet on Twitter. And he's married to Huma. They're separated now, but Huma is Hillary Clinton's lover.
How do you know that her
top aide.
How do you know that? Do you know that to be true?
I'm pretty sure. There's enough evidence to suggest that they definitely probably sleep together. But it's her top aide. You know, this woman, like, the only way to get to Hillary Clinton, and you read
it. Oh, I know.
You read through
I know
the
all
emails.
About
the
it.
Only way to get to Hillary is through Huma. That's Weiner is her husband. And of course it's a sham marriage. I mean, just like Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton, that's a sham marriage. They're probably rarely in the same state at the same time, much less in the same bedroom.
What about mainstream media doing a havana 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 havana? We never were
biased. Oh,
we never showed bias. We were always reporting fair. And I mean, I'm going, what? Oh my God.
Go ahead.
One person today on mainstream media said, "Hey, look, man, when you referred to Trump, you said it was trashy. When you referred to Hillary just 5 minutes ago, you said it was unprofessional or something with Trump."
Yeah.
Did you hear that one? I forgot who it was.
No, I heard your show the other night where they were playing all the times that anytime anybody started talking about Hillary in a negative way, their feed would get dropped. Oh, we lost them.
But here's the funny part, Chris. It's not funny. This American public has been duped. They've been hoodwinked over this woman.
Oh, she's so disgusting.
Well, we know that.
I saw a disgusting video.
But here's the thing: she is now panicked and going straight for the Mexican vote.
Oh, the illegal vote.
Yes.
The illegal vote.
Yeah.
There is so much fraud.
She had a fiesta. She hosted a fiesta earlier in Arizona, and I was looking to see if Apocalypse was there.
She is crooked, she is disgusting, and she needs to be defeated and thrown in jail.
Well, you know, and it's like this one guy said, I totally agreed, I was just like, wanted to stand up and cheer. He said, you know, we're talking about Donald Trump, who has said a couple of things like all guys say, done a little bit of this. When you look at Hillary Clinton, she has stole millions upon millions upon millions of dollars from, I mean, she's taken it in bribe money. She's been bought.
And by Wall Street. Totally.
13 days away, 11 days away from her possibly being the leader of the free country, or the free world, and she's still telling lies. And what I mean by that is she said today, right into their faces, Comey only sent that email to the Republican members of Congress. Bull crap. It was sent to everyone, and she knew that. She bald-faced lied. Let me tell you something. I'll give you a little secret. My sister-in-law got out of town and her and her husband just went off to Timbuktu. They're like, we got to get out of here. I mean, that's
don't they like work for Hillary?
Yeah.
Or something?
Oh yeah, they're big time too. They're big time. What does that tell you?
Yeah. Well, everybody's got people like that in their family. But you know how full of hatred Hillary Clinton supporters are. Go and look at the video of these Hillary Clinton supporters beating up this old homeless lady who was defending Donald Trump's Hollywood Walk of Fame star because it's been vandalized, all these things have been done to it, and she's standing there guarding it. They push her on the ground. They tear up all her signs. This old homeless lady. These Hillary Clinton supporters are hateful people. They are filled with hatred. They're violent, they're vicious, and they're disgusting people, her supporters.
Apocalypse says he didn't go to the rally today. He slept in, and Joe says he cannot wait till the 9th. It's lefty Christmas. You know, I am not convinced, y'all, that he is going to win. In fact, I'm pretty sure that she will. He will probably get the populist vote. There's no way that won't happen because what's going on. Now, the only thing that's going to stop this is I hope that if she doesn't get desperate and have Trump killed.
Debbie, it's going to be a landslide. It's going to be a landslide Trump just like it was in 80. In 1980, all of the polls said that Jimmy Carter was going to win the election. He only won one state.
Really?
All the polls are rigged. Yeah, straight up until election day, every poll said Jimmy Carter was going to be
Apocalypse,
rigged.
Look that up. Apocalypse is the new show researcher. Apocalypse, please do. Wait a second. I have to make an announcement. Apocalypse, please research the 1980, what is it, Chris? Election. And
election for 1980. All the polls said Carter was going to win.
Please verify that and call register
and
for
Reagan. You know, Trump is going to win in a landslide. It's going to be closer because there's so much voter fraud. If we were allowed to have an election without voter fraud, without illegals voting, he would win almost every state.
Did you hear what Barack Obama said? He called Comey and said, "You're doing this just because of this election." And I'm thinking, well, what are you doing just because of this election? I mean, they're just, it is so fourth grade what's going on with this country. And I just don't see it coming back. I mean, they are really got this country divided. I saw today where a black girl was burning the flag, and one of the Donald Trump supporters says, "What are you doing?" And she said, "This country is based on lies and bullshit. This country." And the former Republican nominee that dropped out, what was his name? The heavier guy that...
Chris Christie?
Yes. He goes, "This is unbelievable." He goes, this is unprecedented what's going on in this country right now. It's unbelievable.
Well, that's what they're being taught in schools, especially inner city schools. The curriculum is America oppresses, America is evil, America oppresses other countries, America oppresses minorities, and then they have to answer on their tests. Like, who does America oppress? Blacks? Minorities? Other countries, or all of the above? All of the above. And that's what they have to, like, recite on their tests. So they come out of school indoctrinated to think that America is horrible.
I know. And let me tell you something else, Chris. I know exactly what you're talking about. Also, God, what was I going to freaking say? Damn it. It was so important. crap. When you said that about kids.
I take your train of thought away when I start talking about my awesome stuff.
Hey, I talk about awesome stuff too. I'm just as awesome as you are.
Yeah, I guess so.
Well,
but you know what? Donald Trump has an awesome view for this country. And he is patriotic. He's strong. He doesn't take any bullshit from anybody.
I know what it was before I forget. I did research and tried to find every single audio piece that I could find where Donald Trump talks about immigration with the Muslims. Never one time does he say he wants to get rid of all the Muslims. What he says is he wants to put a stop to incoming Muslims. He doesn't want to throw the Muslims that are here out. They have misrepresented him, and I think that's really sad because they're lying to the American people, and that's how they get ready to do their voting.
You know, and from what we were talking about before, it's really important for America's safety that Trump gets elected because Russia is
Wait a minute. We have a report from Apocalypse, and it says, let me see what we have. Political Woodstock's over there at the Liz chat room. It says, hold on, I'm trying to get there. I'm trying to find my show page. Okay. He says, 1980, Reagan carried 44 states and Carter carried 6. The popular vote was Reagan, 43 million, and Carter, 35 million. And then Stabby says, this is classic. What?
That's the way I think it's going to be with Trump. But the important thing is, though, is that before that election,
so who
the
won?
Media and all the polls were calling it for Carter.
So who won?
Reagan kicked his ass, and it was the election was over. It was called by 9:30. Carter conceded after just an hour and a half after the polls closed.
But the Democrats, Stabby McHugs, say, well, you know, he wants to throw, you know, even Hillary goes, he wants to go from school to school, from house to house, and throw everybody out of this country. No, he did not. He just said that he wanted to cut down on the end, watch the people that are coming in, which is completely fair and completely honest. I think he should. He wants to tighten it up. And these other people are wanting to just open the borders and just let the floodgates in, and that's dangerous, guys.
We need to kick out the illegals. What's wrong with kicking out the illegals? Why has that all of a sudden become like a horrible thing?
It's not.
They're here illegally. They need to get out.
Well, they would certainly kick us out of their country if we were there illegal, I can tell you that.
Yeah, yes, they would.
Have you tried to get out of Cancun with a few bags that you bought stuff in? Let's see, Apocalypse says 489 electoral votes went to Reagan, and Carter won only 49. So what is that? I mean, what's the big deal? I don't understand.
The big deal of that,
it looked like Reagan was going to win anyway. It looked like Reagan was going to win anyway.
Reagan won in a landslide. But why I brought that up is all of the polls said Carter was going to win up until Election Day. What I'm saying is polls cannot be trusted.
Okay, so what you're
Reagan
saying...
Because Reagan won in a landslide.
Yeah, because there's a lot of polls out that are already giving it to Hillary. They're already saying that she's got 272 electoral votes. And that's really not possible because the Electoral College comes from the populist vote of the state.
Yeah, but even Washington Post, which is like Hillary's newspaper, their poll even has it closer. And Trump is going to win in a landslide, I believe. And then, you know, all these obnoxious Hillary supporters can just shove it, you know?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm the kind of person, I just don't want to jinx it and say anything really right now. I mean, it could really go either way. Here's what I will say. I will talk about facts. Comey said today when he was talking on something, he said, I've got my tired voice tonight. I'm really tired. So just ignore the way I sound. I have the vocal fry. And Comey said today, he said he will not publicly humiliate himself again like he did last time, which tells me he's going to prosecute her.
Right on. I hope he prosecutes her right away.
And I thought she had him in his back. I mean, I just hope he doesn't accidentally show up suicide. You know what I'm talking about? But still.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Because the Clintons are not beyond killing people. They've done it before. They have had Vince Foster killed. They've had multiple people hit.
Well, you know that fat guy that works, that's one of their hitmen? His name is Beckles or Bob Beckles or Larry Beckles.
Yeah, Bob Beckles, yeah.
Not the old guy that has to have oxygen, not that guy, but the other guy that said, you know what I mean? The other guy that...
You're thinking of Charles Krauthammer, right
there. No, not the guy that goes, you know, I worked for the Clintons for 40 years, and I hate that guy. I could have got him on my show, and I thought, I can't listen to his voice.
That's Bob Beckles.
That's not the one. I'm thinking of the guy that said, he said, we should just kill Julian Assange. He said, just take him out there and blow him away. You know, he said,
thank God for Julian Assange. Thank God for WikiLeaks. I am so glad that WikiLeaks is out there. And you know what? He is afraid that she's going to drone him. They took his internet connection. You know, this is the thing. Back when WikiLeaks was dumping all those cables about the Iraq war and making Bush look bad, all them on the left, they loved Julian Assange.
Yeah.
But now that he's making them look bad, they want to kill him.
I want you to hear this guy that looks like he's in the mob actually threatened to kill Julian Assange.
So everybody's going nuts about Donald Trump recommending...
Hold on. Here he goes.
We should do with Julian Assange. Are you ready? This is amazing.
The way to deal with this is pretty simple. We got special ops forces. I mean, a dead man can't leak stuff. This guy's a traitor, a treasonous, and he has broken every law of the United States. The guy ought to be, and I'm not for the death penalty, so if I'm not for the death penalty, the only way to do it, illegally shoot the son of a...
That sounds like Bob Beckel.
Yeah, he's a fat guy. Is your Bob Beckel?
That sounds like Bob Beckel.
Okay.
Well, you know what was so interesting... Julian Assange was a patriot back when WikiLeaks first came out, and he was dumping documents on the Iraq war. Oh, all the left, they were all calling him a patriot. He was, you know, standing up for freedom and da-da-da.
Well,
but
how
now
can
that
you
he's
call...
leaking stuff about their person...
How can you say that Julian Assange is a traitor when he's Australian?
You know, yeah, he's Swedish. And they trumped up charges against him, and now he's hiding out in South America, in the Venezuelan embassy or so. I don't know how he got.
You know what? A friend of mine that's going to the Million Mask March here in just a few days said that if something happens to Julian Assange, they are planning, and if Hillary Clinton gets elected, they are planning the Billion Mask March on Washington.
Good. It'll be just like in V for Vendetta.
Oh, that's right. That's what they were talking about.
Yeah.
I was in their IRC chat today, and this is where some of the big dicks in Anonymous were in there. And I didn't want to mention Assange. I was just talking about some this and some music and all this kind of stuff. And I was over sitting outside in the sun at this garage sale. And one of them said, hey, you know, if that happens to J.A., you know, and you can just kind of read between the lines what they're saying. They're planning the Billion Mask March. They're gonna march on Washington about it if he shows up dead. I don't think he's dead. I think he just went underground.
He's hiding out there because he doesn't want to come out. Because if he's afraid if he stands on the porch, he'll be droned.
Yeah. And but one of his friends walked out in front of a train. I mean, who does that?
Really? Yeah. I like, you know, I mean, I am glad that we have Julian Assange and Edward Snowden to expose all this corruption. And you know what's really funny? It's, you know how, you know, when you think of email getting hacked, you think, oh, it was people doing this, like somehow this encryption or whatever that busted into his account. But when an email account is hacked, 99% of the time, it's because they acquire the person's password. And that's exactly how this Podesta's email was hacked. Now, John Podesta, this guy's been around for a while, Center for American Progress. He's an evil, evil dude. And His email was breached. This is on the Smoking Gun. Somebody sent him an email that looked like it was from Gmail, saying somebody has your password. Somebody just use your password to sign account johnpodesta@gmail.com. Details, the IP address. Google stopped the sign-in attempt. You should change your password immediately. And then a giant link that says change password, best the Gmail team. So this and the person that was opening his emails is this little schmuck, this little schmuck here, William Reinhart. Right? No, this guy. It doesn't matter what his name is. Delavan, this guy Charles Delavan, this little pipsqueak, opened it up and was like, "This is a legitimate email." Quote, "John needs to change his password immediately and ensure that two-factor authorization is turned on his account." And they all went nuts. And somebody clicked the link. And that change password link led them to a fake Gmail page where they gave the hackers his password, and they were able to access his email account.
You know, they have programs that you can use that people... What?
This is like one of the oldest tricks. Like, you're not supposed to click on a link that says change your password, hey, if he's dumb enough, if his staff is stupid enough to give away his password to somebody, then they deserve to be hacked.
Well, they have programs that will constantly continue to try to guess your password. You know.
Or you can just get the person to just give it to you. It was his stupid idiot IT people. It was John Podesta himself was the one that gave his password to the hackers. And they were able to access all his emails. I think that's fantastic. You know, these people, they really deserve to go down.
Yeah, I agree. I just don't know how this is going to come out. And I also don't know what everybody's going to be talking about when this is all over with.
Yep. I'm very excited about it. Very excited. I think that we're going to see a major Trump victory.
I don't know.
Well, I better get back into work before people start wondering where I am.
All right. Well, call back if you get back out.
Okay.
Chris Nelson, everybody, on the Debbie Daly Train Wreck here with you on Saturday night, the Debbie Daly Actual Train Wreck. Yeah, Stabby, hate her all you want. It's not that she likes it. I'll explain to you what I know. I look past it. And that's all I'll say. It's like... If you want me to be honest, I'll be gutly honest, because when I'm tired, I'm real honest about everything. I mean, I'm honest anyway, but I get really too honest. It's like a child going, "I hate you, Mommy," which I've never heard those words, but he doesn't hate me. He doesn't hate me. Now, some of you may say, "I'm in denial." Yes, he does. He doesn't. Yeah. He looks past the stuff I do. And it's his chat room and my show. He makes the rules. Right, Stab? B? I can't call him Pumpkin or anything. I have to call him Stabby. Just Stabby. Because we're serious when we talk about Stabby. Now, what was I going to do? I didn't even finish my song, my intro, before everybody started calling and talking and everything. Let's go back to the song that I know all the words to. I used to write down words to songs, you know. This has got weird words. Oh, no, let's don't do that. I want to show y'all this scene. Okay, so I was talking about my friend Tyler telling me about the scene, and then that went to the Old West, and I mentioned my grandfather. Then I started talking about the cotton gins. See, I'm doing good. Look at me. I'm actually keeping up with what I was talking about. Okay, I was talking about... I was talking about the scene from Old Men. What is the name of the damn movie? It's called No Country for Old Men. And I really tried. I mean, I really, really tried to watch it. And Tyler was saying that when he was in college, that you had to do a scene from a movie that was high tension. The highest you could figure out, and you could do from any film. Well, he said his roommate or his friend did the one from Tombstone, where they spoke to each other in Latin. And he says, well, it seems that Mr. Ringgold is an educated man. Now I really hate him. And she goes, you don't even know him. He goes, no, there's just something about him around the eyes. And he reminds me of me. And he goes, in vita veritat, which means in wine there is much truth. And he comes back and he says, Ajay Karajas, because I've done all the research on it. Well, anyway, okay, so he does that one. Well, this guy, Tyler, who came by today to say, to talk for a long time, God, he talked forever, said he did the one from No Country for Old Men. I'd never seen the film, but Sonny and One Angry Jew were on my show a couple of weeks ago, and they said, you've got to see this movie. It's the greatest movie in the world. And I tried. I really tried. I went to Mad Dog 61, gave me his Netflix sign-in. So I went there, and it was there. And I just, I don't know what it is about me. I would rather watch Aaron Brockovich or How to Lose a Guy in 10 Days or Divine Secrets of the Ya-Ya Sisterhood or the Traveling Pants. I just do. The only real boy movie that I've ever just been addicted to is Tombstone. And that's simply because, like I mentioned, my grandfather was big time into the Old West. He had books and books and books. He had a musket. He had pistols. He had all this kind of stuff. And I was like his little fair-weathered granddaughter. And so I would curl up next to the couch, on the couch, and he would tell me stories. And I was just fascinated by this because I could not believe that there was a time when we lived where there was no law. And men were judged by how well they could handle a pistol. If you could shoot straight, and supposedly it's not easy to do, to really shoot straight. Because at the cop shop here in Dallas, you have to go in and qualify every, I don't know, 6 weeks or something like that. Requalify. You have to go to the firing range. And because I used to ask him, I said, well, why was a little guy like Doc Holliday that was so sickly, why was he so feared? And he told me, he said, because Deborah, back in the old days, in the Wild, Wild West, a man was judged by how well he could shoot a pistol. And I said, well, anybody can shoot a pistol. I said, oh, no, they can't. He said, you go out and just in the spur of the moment, riding on a horse or high tension or whatever, you know, you just pull it out of your holster and just point it and aim. You know, I mean, just aim and shoot. And he said, it's very hard to do. And certain men could do it and certain men couldn't do it. And that's how that's the men that were feared, whether they were good men or bad men, you know. And Johnny Ringgold was one of the best. And if you were really good, you could shoot with both of your hands or something like that. And Doc Holliday was supposedly amazing with a gun, a pistol or whatever. And so the reason I bring that up is because Tyler was telling me that a lot of this was shot on location. Well, it was shot on location and down around Palo Duro Canyon and things along those lines. And he was saying that a lot of these men from Tombstone were actually from this part of the world. And there's some. So I started looking at Google Maps when I was sitting there waiting for somebody to walk up to that stupid garage sale. And I was just, you know, flipping. And I was zooming in on different parts of Texas. You know, there's some really barren parts down here. I mean, there's some, you know, there's some really snake slithering, coyote howling parts out there in western Texas up around the Caprock, which made me say my grandfather was a capitalist coming from East Texas and moving to West Texas back in the late 40s when there was a cotton boom out, because The reason there was a cotton boom out in West Texas is because of the land. I mean, the actual dirt. You can't plant cotton in this clay that we live in. We live in a, where we live, it's real hard dirt. It's cold and it's clay and it's real thick and it's black. And up there, it's real sandy, as you all know. I'm not teaching y'all anything I know. I'm just talking. And so he moves his entire family out there, except for one. The black sheep, my father. He didn't want to go to West Texas. He wanted to stay here, so he stayed here. And he was going to do his own thing. But anyway, that's beside the point. Well, he gets out there, and he tells his wife, we're going to pack up and leave. And she's like, what? We're going to pack up and leave. We're going to go buy a farm out in West Texas. And she was like, what? Well, my grandmother, who I am supposedly identical to, look like, act like, everything, she was very, she was a, hold on, Mr. Landlord. Joe?
Hi.
Oh, I was scared. My heart jumped. I thought you were the Jew. Hi, Joe.
I gotta mute your show. Joe? Yeah, there we go.
I enjoyed talking to you this morning. It was really nice waking up to Wake and Bake with Joe.
Yeah, it was. It was cool.
So, yeah, I was talking about... He was a capitalist.
You're talking about your grandfather being a maverick or something.
Oh, he was a capitalist. He came out there and nobody in West Texas had a cotton gin repair service. So he not only stuck my grandmother on, I think he bought like something like 600 acres or something. He had a big thing and he planted soybean, cotton, and sunflowers and corn. So, yeah. Did you know that we couldn't walk through the corn because it would be like real weird and stuff? We'd get lost. Joe?
Cool.
So, did you talk to Barco? Are you going to go do the deal? Do you want to talk about it on my show? No?
Yeah, I'm going to go to Barco's the end of November and
wow.
Help him move some shit and go to some hockey games.
Wow, that sounds like fun. Fudge, I'm so jealous.
You know, I'm just gonna just say it right out there. If you know, if I have to put out for it, I guess I will. You know, I'm getting too old to be fussy at this point. You know, so
there you go. Do that. So will you be fine?
A girl's got to do what a girl's got to do, right?
Yes, you do. And I think it's good for you to have something planned since your recent breakup with that woman, whatever you want to call her. That
who, the born-again Baptist woman?
Yes, Tammy Faye Baker.
Yeah. Some relationships, you know, at the start, they're just not going to last.
Did she ever make you pray? Did she ever say, Joe, you need Jesus in your life?
No. She tried to have a few discussions with me, and she ended up very frustrated.
I would take you as you are. You don't meet up with somebody to try to change them. I would just love the fact that you're just who you are.
Yeah, that's what I say.
You have to accept people for the way they are. You can't go into something thinking you're going to, well, he'll change, or I'll change him, or I'll change her, or I'll get her not to do drugs, or get her to stop drinking. No, you take them for as you've got them. And she probably messed up. Has she tried to contact you or anything?
No, I haven't talked to her in weeks.
Well, fuck her then.
So.
Maybe she was a gold digger too. Who knows? She fucked up, I know that, because you're a really cool guy.
That's what I said too. Fuck her. Hit the fucking road.
Did she leave another dog?
No pets get left behind in this one.
Yeah, that's good. So, have you talked to Debbie?
Debbie's around all the time.
What did Debbie think about her?
It was actually pretty funny. The first time Debbie saw her, Debbie looked like we were pulling out of my yard, and Debbie was walking by, and they made eye contact.
What'd she say?
And then, like, when I seen her, Debbie, a couple days later, Debbie said, who was that guy that you were here with the other day? I said, what guy? And then she described the guy. I said, that wasn't a guy, Debbie. That was my girlfriend. She goes, oh, she looks like a boy. And I fucking laughed because all women are the same.
We are catty. You're all catty. Catty as fuck.
You're all catty. God, you're all right. Catty as fuck.
You're right. Because we know how to push our own buttons.
Now they're saying in the chat that I hate God.
Why do you hate God?
I didn't know I did. I hated him.
Have you ever seen a boy movie called No Country for Old Men?
Yep, I've seen that.
I watched a boy movie with you one time on a Sunday, and I was like, oh my God, this is killing me. I love Joe, but I cannot believe I'm watching. What movie did we watch?
I don't know now.
Yeah, it was some movie about a guy that was in a town, and he was killing everybody, and it was Clint Eastwood, and it was The Drifter, The High Plains Drifter. Was that it?
Oh, High Plains Drifter. Yeah, I remember that.
Oh my God, I was going, I don't believe I'm watching this movie. I did it just for you. I mean, anybody in my real life would go, Debbie, watch The High Plains Drifter? Are you kidding me? I really suffered through boy movies. But I watched it for Joe, and I was like, and I was trying to understand. I was like, why did he do that? Why did that happen? Why did that happen? It was really a good movie, but wasn't Mr. White watching it with us too? Or something? No?
I think so. I think there was a few of us, wasn't there?
No, it was just me and you, and then Mr. White stepped in, and I said, I made up some lie that I had to go for some reason because I didn't like the movie. Aw, I love you, Joe. You know what? In the old movie, and wouldn't you know the very first scene in one of the old men for old country movie that I was watching, because the Jew and Sonny said it was the best movie in the world, they shoot a dog. I'm like, oh, good. Thank you. That's great.
Yeah, they do a lot of killing in that movie.
Yeah, there is. And I don't even want to know what happens, because who is the main guy that does the coin toss scene? The actor?
I don't know what his name is, but he's a pretty disturbing character in that movie.
Yeah,
he's a pretty cold and calculated fella.
Yeah, he shot two of his friends right in the head when he went out there, execution style. And that's as far, I got as far as to the guy ran away or something, and his wife said, call me, and then I was like, I'm done, I can't do this.
Yeah, that was a pretty big scene.
I know, but I have to have, like, romance and a plot and all kinds of stuff. Is he going to come back? Where did she go? I have to have, like, love and romance. I'm into that stuff in movies, but whatever. It's okay.
Yeah, there you go. That's good, too.
Would you watch Sleepless in Seattle with me if you had to?
Only if I thought you were going to put out at the end.
Of course. I would probably put out the
beginning. Oh, yeah, I'd watch it, man. I've done all kinds of things worse than that. For a little nookie, I fucking walked in the rain and as a teenager for fucking hours.
See, now let's talk about that. That blows my mind. I mean, are you kidding me? Are guys really that? Can't y'all just...
Well, when I headed out, I told myself I was going to hitchhike. Hey, but, you know, yeah, guys are that construct.
Really? Is it that bad?
Yeah, you know, there's an invisible force that makes the ducks fly south in the winter, and it makes young fellas chase pussy through the rain. Right?
Is it what they say? Is it that inert urge to procreate or something like that? What is that? Is that what it is, you think?
Sure.
Whatever you say. No, it's just the pussy, right?
Yeah, well, you know, whatever. Like, it's the end result.
You know what is the most depressing movie that's running on HBO right now? It's called Gia. Have you ever seen that movie called Gia?
I'm not sure if I have or not.
Yeah.
I haven't had HBO for a couple of months. When Game of Thrones ended, I took HBO off. It's fucking $18 a month here.
Really? Our cable is $200 a month. We have ultra-high-speed cable.
I use that couch tuner now to watch all them shows.
I can't go to Couch Tuner anymore. No, I can go to Couch Tuner. I can't go to Put Locker. Have you tried to go to Put Locker?
No, I never did. I just go to Couch Tuner.
Oh, you've got to do Put Locker. It's the best. It's where you can watch any movie in the whole world. Just and you don't have to join. You don't have to sign up. You just go there to the website and click your movie and click play. But I can't go there anymore. Can anybody in the chat room go to Put Locker anymore? I got blocked out of it for some reason. Of course, I was watching a lot of movies.
Now, my girlfriend, ex-girlfriend, had a new laptop that had Windows 10 on it.
Mm-hmm.
And we could not get her laptop onto Coach Tuner at all. It would block it. You couldn't get on there at all. I could, for her host, I could go on to Coach Tuner with my laptop. Mm-hmm. But when we tried to go on to the exact same website, I would send her the link with her laptop. It wouldn't let her on.
I'm going to try to go to Put Locker right now, which is my favorite website, Put Locker. I click.
Now, I'm sure there's probably ways you can shut the media settings off, but I know Windows 10 has a lot of anti-piracy features in it.
Now, wouldn't you know, I'm there. There I am. Stupid me. I'm actually at Put Locker tonight. How stupid is that? I made a fool out of myself. I just clicked on Birth of a Nation, which is a brand new film. It just came out October.
It's not very good, though, is it?
No, that's not the one. I'm thinking of. These aren't very good, but the older, you can watch anything. I mean, just, it's amazing the movies that you can watch on Put Locker. I've watched everything.
I watched a pretty cool movie the other day on Netflix. Yeah, I don't ever remember hearing about it, but it was a Tom Cruise movie. And The Edge of Tomorrow, it's all about an alien invasion. But it's sort of like Groundhog Day. He keeps reliving the same day as death. But each day he can change it.
I think that's what it's called. The other day I watched Independence Day.
Yeah, that's a good one to watch. Independence Day 2 sucks.
Oh, absolutely. It was stupid. And Tom Cruise, was it called Jack Reacher? No, that's a new one. It just got released. Put Locker does the first release. I mean, they're like, they just released Snowden. It's on Put Locker too, and the new Ghostbusters. And what else is on there? Skip Trace is on there. Independence Day. Why did that all of a sudden show up for no reason? Have you seen Sully? Do you know all about Sully?
Yeah, I know who Sully is.
You know what he did, right?
Yeah, he landed the airplane in the Hudson River.
Did you see Tom Hanks doing a satire about Sully on Saturday Night Live? Do y'all get Saturday Night Live up there?
Yep.
Did you see
We get it on Tuesday, though.
So. I knew you were going to say that. I fucking knew you were going to say that. You know, if you were in Ice Age, you would be the big, what's the guy that's the big guy, the great big guy that walks around? He's a, what were the elephants called back a long time ago? They were called Mastodons?
Mastodons?
Yeah, he's the main player. That would be you. Because you have to decide what Ice Age creature you would be. Stabby would be that little guy that goes like, wah, wah, wah. He's always mad and stuff. Anyway, I'm being silly. I've been hanging around kids too much lately, I guess.
You're watching a lot of kids' movies, haven't you?
I know. I'm really stupid. Now,
my young fella's favorite thing was Thomas the Tank Engine. Oh, fuck. It used to drive me nuts. You'd watch it for hours.
Well, here's the thing.
Abominable Snowman?
No, he would be the Abominable Snowman. He's not in the snow. He's in a beautiful country. What was I going to tell you? God damn it. Some kid movies are good, Joe, and I'm not kidding. Have you ever seen... Well, you probably haven't seen any of them.
Yes, they are. Some kid movies are hilarious.
Who's the one...
You know, it's real fun to do.
What?
It's real fun to take, like, Jet's the right age right now to go to a movie at the theater with a whole theater full of kids and watch a funny movie, and then when something happens and all the kids laugh at the same time, it's awesome. Because me and the ex-wife took Matthew, my son, to see Shrek for his birthday, and he was like 4 or 5 years old. And the first Shrek movie. Mm-hmm. You remember the scene when the donkey lifts his leg and pisses on the campfire?
Yes, yes, yes. I do.
Every kid in that fucking place broke up, and it's just got a sound all of its own. It really does. It really does. It's fucking...
Did you know when Jurassic Park came out, I took Steven and Heather to the movie theater to see Jurassic Park, and when that first T-Rex screamed and roared real loud, Steven screamed so loud, I had to take him out of the movie and take him home, and I had to leave Heather there with Victor. He would not go back in that theater. He would not go back in that theater. It was so goddamn loud, Jurassic Park. It was unbelievably loud. I mean, it was like deafening loud. It was so loud. Did you see Jurassic Park in the theater or anything like that?
I went and seen the Star Wars last year at Christmas time in 3D.
Oh, that's, you gave a review on that too.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember that. I remember listening to your review. Your review.
You know, being 580 pounds, I don't find movie theaters all that comfortable. So.
I usually have to arrange. Your pictures don't look 580 pounds.
Oh, yeah, 580 for sure. I usually have to call ahead and make special arrangements with the manager to allow me just to sit in the aisle.
Shut up, right. Joe. You don't weigh 580.
No, shit.
No, you don't.
Sure, now that I have a Rascal, they just let me drive that in, and I just sit up by the fire exit.
You're so stupid. You're being mean to yourself. Hey, what is your, I mean, if you had to say, what is your favorite all-time movie? I know that's a hard question for a lot of people to answer, but what is one of your favorite, or just one of your favorite all-time movies?
The Longest Day.
The Longest Day. Now, what is that about? Is that about the apocalypse, when the nuclear war?
Oh, it's about D-Day.
Yeah, The Longest Day. That's on YouTube for free.
Oh, yeah.
Is that where the old lady was like trying to plan that wedding, and she didn't want to admit that it was happening, and then the nuclear war happens, and it's really sad and stuff? That one, is that The Longest Day, or am I thinking wrong?
No. The Longest Day is all about the invasion of Normandy. And it had all the main actors of the time, but none of them had star billing. Had like John Wayne and all them guys in it.
So you like war movies?
I like, yeah, they're probably my favorite, but I like any movie that's sort of a new idea, right?
Do you know how many movies were made about the Korean War?
I know there's a couple. Pork Chop Hill's a pretty good one.
Mr. Midnight Movie tried to name them one time, and he couldn't name hardly any of them because there wasn't that many made. But we found out that there was a fuck ton of them made. There was a bunch of them made. Okay. Do you recognize this song? Tell me what this is from. Hold on. Wait. Let me click forward. Okay, here we go. Here it comes.
The Bridge Over the River Kwai.
You are good. That's a movie about the... Isn't that about the Korean War?
No, that's about... They were building a railroad for the Japanese army. Prisoners of war, I think, across Burma. Anyway, and they were building the bridge. And, and if you've seen the movie, after they build it, they blow it the fuck up.
Now, what is the Devil's Brigade?
The Devil's Brigade was really the first special forces joint unit, Canadians and Americans.
Was it a film?
Yeah, well, it ended up being a movie, but it was a real thing.
Tell me about it. What was it?
Well, they were a joint unit made up of Canadians and Americans.
To do what?
And they were special force. They were like commandos.
To do what? In the Second World War?
Yeah, Second World War. They fought in Italy.
This says the Devil's Brigade, the arrival of the Canadians. I'm assuming it's some sort of music or something.
Yeah, well, the thing about the movie is that it's a movie, right?
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Yeah. Very true. So, that's very true. So. What was I going to say though about that? My favorite war movie, I guess, would be Saving Private Ryan.
That's a pretty good one. You know, a movie that came out at the same time as Saving Private Ryan.
What's that?
That never got a lot of publicity because Saving Private Ryan was such a big hit. But it's a really, really good World War II movie too. It's called When Trumpets Fade.
When Trumpets Fade.
If you've never seen it, it's worth watching. It's worth It's real cool.
And it's just about World War II. When Trumpets Fade, right here it says trailer. And they said something about, you know, what is that noise? Here's the trailer to When Trumpets Fade. Let me see if they talk or if it's just a bunch of music.
He was a reluctant soldier.
If I can help you in any way without endangering my own life, I won't hesitate.
See, these kind of movies are really weird because these are the kind of movies that my father and my uncles were in, my great uncles and stuff, not my uncles, but my great uncles were in. It was really weird and sad. You know, so many more men survived World War II than they did in Vietnam. So many people didn't come home from Vietnam. It's really sad. You know?
Well, Vietnam was longer than World War II.
Is it true that more people were killed in the Vietnam War than all of the wars combined?
I don't think that's true. I don't know.
I don't either.
But as far as America is concerned, like, Vietnam lasted way longer than World War II did for you guys.
Vietnam started when Johnson sent them over there in 63. And the last man out was 75, right? It's 12
years.
Yeah,
like, you guys were only in like the World War II for like 3 years, if it was that long. Yeah, 42 to 45.
But I don't think that Vietnam was a real war. It was more like, I mean, that's going to piss off some people that went over there like Sonny and stuff, but it was more like a policing of two nations that weren't getting along, really. I mean, we took up arms with South Korea. You know what I'm saying?
The Korean War ended up.
I mean, I'm sorry. I meant Vietnam. I said Korea. I'm sorry.
No, there was a North Vietnam and a South Vietnam, and when it was over, there was only one Vietnam. It was very much democracy against communism, but.
Yeah, but we weren't really fighting against one person for us versus them. We allied with somebody and just kind of helped them out. Wouldn't you agree?
Well, and that's sort of what the Russians did too. But the big thing was is the Vietnamese people were, you know, their heart wasn't into it. Like they weren't on the side of the West. Like, they had been exploited for years. They were on the side of the Ho Chi Minh side, like the Viet Cong side, for the most part.
Now, wait a minute. Barco says Civil War was the big one because Americans were killing Americans. World War II was the most global. Civil War was the most Americans killed. That's true, I guess. There was, well, I don't know. I'm going to look it up because I don't know. Well, Apocalypse? Hold on, I have to make an announcement. Apocalypse, do research on most men killed in war, please. Apocalypse, and report to Register 4.
we got a ketchup spill at aisle 3.
No, we do. We always have that. But more importantly, outside line and garden, line 4, please. Outside line and garden, line 4. I don't know. Goose and I play on these stupid things, and we get crazy with it. We were doing it the other night on my show. Did you ever get a chance to hear Goose on my show the other night? God, it was hysterical.
I want to hear the one angry Jew talk to that Pluto guy about 9/11.
Pluto can't stand the Jew. He won't do it because he hates him.
I know, but I would love to hear the Jew talk his Jew talk.
I actually have. When he went up against the Skype assholes, he debated them on 9/11. I have that. if you want to hear some of it.
And how did he do with that Pluto?
Well, they kind of. I actually moderated it, and it's right. Wait a minute. Where is it? It's right. I don't know. You'd have to be the judge of yourself. Let's see. I've got Debbie versus Goofy debate. I've got. I'm in the wrong show. No, I'm not. I'm in this one. Let's see. Fear mongering radio music. The big debate of. Oh, I thought that was you. Never mind. Barco, Trump versus Hillary. I put in debate. Two of the greatest guys debating. It's on here somewhere. The great debate of Mr. Solution and JP. The big debate tonight only. Let me see. I don't know. I'll find it. Yeah, he actually went up against them, and he showed up, and they showed up, and it was kind of interesting. Pluto was on there, too. There's a lot of them.
Well, what's frustrating, you know, and I'm not looking to get into another big thing because I'm not, but the Jew refuses to acknowledge anything you say, right?
Yep.
And the example I'm going to use is he says, jet fuel won't melt steel. And mm-hmm. when you try to say, well, steel doesn't have to melt before it fails, in the simple act of blacksmithing, which is a known technology they've used for centuries and centuries and centuries, you know, proves that. And he just looks right past that and talks to you like you're crazy. So, you know, like, so how can you reason with that logic?
Well, and that's why most men don't like talking to the Jew, because the Jew is, like you said, he puts on a one-sided conversation, and he doesn't acknowledge what you say, and that's called being a prick. I mean, people wouldn't play golf with a Jew. Men don't like the Jew, and the one angry, and he thinks that they're scared of him. And I said, no, they're not. They actually can't stand you because you're a jerk. You're a prick. That's all it is. It's not anything to do with it. Oh, Apocalypse reported already. He said in the Civil War, it was 750,000 in World War II. World War I was 405,000. Vietnam was 116,000. Korean was 58,000. Revolutionary was, and then 25,000 was Barco. No. My bad. The Civil War was 750,000 casualties. World War II was 405. Vietnam was 58. Korean was 54. And the Revolutionary was 25,000. Wow. Now, Sonny from Monster Boss Radio says, since there was no declaration of war, the exact dates are sketchy. However, it is now widely accepted that the Vietnam War started on November the 1st of 1955 and lasted until April 30th of 1975, which is roughly 20 years. Damn.
Yeah, you guys had what they call advisors and everything in there and guys in there training the Soviet Vietnamese Army after the French got out of there. I think even before the French pulled out.
Apocalypse, please report to the manager's office, please. Apocalypse, report to the manager's office.
But Sonny was certainly no more about that than
Sonny is an expert on the Vietnam War. He knows a lot about it and helps a lot of people who got messed up with the Vietnam War.
Yeah, well, they recognize, like, them guys that come home from Vietnam, it took them years to even recognize the post-traumatic stress, and even now today, the guys that come home from Afghanistan and Iraq and stuff are still, like, even though it's acknowledged that it exists, they're still fighting the fight, right? It's fucking...
I know, it's sad. It's very sad. You know, there was a movie a long time ago that I watched about that, and I can't remember what it was. Anyway, yeah...
A real good movie about post-traumatic stress and them guys coming home is that Tommy Lee Jones movie, The Valley of Allah.
The Valley of Nevada? Is that what you said?
The Valley of Allah.
Valley of Allah. I don't think I've ever seen that. Have you ever seen that one, Sonny? Of course, we're behind. They wait 20 seconds.
It's his son and them, he's in the Army, and they come home from Iraq. Anyway, his son gets murdered, and Tommy Lee Jones goes there and tries to help solve it, and he uncovers it's a bunch of post-traumatic stress stuff. Anyway, it's worth watching. It's long. It's not very exciting, and there's, you know, don't watch it while you're trying. Well, there's people in the room talking type thing, but it's worth watching.
I saw a comedian tonight. His name is, he's like this guy that everybody likes. He's like a man's man. And I don't remember his name, but he was talking about rehab. Have y'all ever heard about this guy? Do y'all know who I'm talking about? Oh, wait a minute.
Rehab's for quitters.
Yeah, exactly. His name is, no, that's not him. And I don't remember his damn name. He was on, HBO. I mean, he was on something early. I forgot what it was, but he was talking about rehab, and I thought, wow, what a funny comedic moment tonight for my show. I forgot his name, what? Though. I honestly don't remember
his name. Joe Rogan?
That's close. He actually said he was coming from Manhattan, and he agreed to go to rehab in Utah. And he says, now, little do you know that when you're going to Utah, that the plane makes a layover in Denver. And he was going in for marijuana, and it was just funny the way he was. It was really making me laugh, and I don't really laugh that much at comedians. I'm pretty funny about, Edison Apple. That's not his name. I would remember that. Anyway, it was really funny. I don't know. I was going to play it tonight, and I don't remember. Does anybody know who that guy is? He's really funny. He looks like I said, a kind of a man's man. Joe Rogan has a movie out. On Netflix.
He's got a new stand-up routine on Netflix. It's pretty funny.
Oh, it's a stand-up routine?
Yeah.
Why do guys like Joe Rogan so much? Is he just a man's man? What is a man's man? Is Bill Burr a man's man?
Well, Bill Burr's sort of man's comedy is pretty funny. But Joe Rogan's pretty funny. Right? You know what I mean?
I thought he was a podcaster.
He is, but he's a stand-up comedian, and he used to host Fear Factor. He does the ringside at the UFC.
I like John Cena. Huh. Do you like John Cena?
Yeah, he's all right.
Why don't you like John Cena? Isn't he a...
I'm just not a big wrestling guy.
Oh, okay. Well, there's a show out that my daughter watches emphatically that's got these two twins that are wrestlers, these girls, and they are beautiful. Man, those girls are gorgeous. And one of them's married to John Cena. Just, I don't know, I just remembered that. I can't remember that damn guy's name. Mark Lundgren. That's not him. I can't find it. I just put in a comedian that talks about rehab. It was so funny to listen to him because he talks all about how... It's just really funny. I love to laugh, though. I just do. I don't know why. I just love laughing. What's his name? Damn it.
So, is the young fella all excited for Halloween?
Are you kidding? Guess who he's going to be?
Who?
He's going to be El Diablo from Suicide Squad. We've got the entire thing.
Cool.
Yeah. It's going to be cute. And then Heather...
Last year, I had 6 kids.
I know, you gave them ketchup packets. You're so stupid. I love you, Joe.
So tonight I was at Walmart, so I thought I better pick up 120 mini chocolate bars in case the kids, you know...
Do you ever see the little girl next door about the garden that y'all had planted and stuff? What about that?
Yeah. But all the stuff is ready. I give her some, and she said, "Oh, I don't like that."
Really? Oh man.
Yeah, she just.
Drats. She didn't like it.
I don't know. She just had a birthday the other day.
Is everything okay with her? I mean, her home life. You should keep a watch on her. You know.
No, she's fine. She's fine. They got a great. They're all right over there.
I made steaks on the grill tonight. They were delicious. Good stuff.
Well, I actually have a bunch of maple and stuff for firewood in my yard.
Do you really?
I tore an old dryer apart last spring. And
you live in the land of Oz.
And I'm going to have a fire in it tomorrow, and I'm going to barbecue some shit on it.
Are you really? Nova Scotia. What a beautiful place to live. It's like living in Hawaii.
Yeah, just like it. Especially right around February.
Shut up.
Right around February 2nd. It's very Hawaii-like around here.
No, I'm saying as far as paradise goes, you idiot. You know what I'm talking about. It's beautiful there. It's gorgeous. Good stuff. Yeah, fun stuff. So I just walked around the Texas State Fair with a cap on that said Dallas Sheriff. Heather goes, Mom, please take that cap off.
I want to go to the Texas State Fair.
It's amazing.
Because they got a booth there that they'll deep fry anything.
Absolutely. It's gross. I ate deep fried avocado and thought it tasted like deep fried vomit. Ugh.
Yeah, I can't imagine that being good.
Oh, it was nasty. Heather goes, oh, Mom, we have to get this. And I was like, what is it? She goes, it's fried avocados. And I was like, okay, it doesn't sound bad. I took one bite, and I swear to you, it tasted like fried vomit. I spit it out. It was that bad.
If I get to the States, I want to try Popeye's chicken.
That's the best chicken in the world.
I want to get some of them shrimp.
Yes, it is delicious, and it's real hot. They put...
And if I ever get down to Bayou Country, I want to get one of them big pots where you get the corn and the potatoes and the crawdads. And the sausage and everything, it all comes in a big pot.
And the egg and stuff, like in the Ya-Ya Sisterhood movie.
They boil it all together, and then they just dump it over in front of you.
Yeah, and you get a boiled egg, and you get but I can't eat those. I've never had a crawfish. That just looks nasty.
No, I've eaten enough lobsters and seafood and stuff. That don't bother me.
But to me, that's like eating the roaches of the sea. I mean, those are nasty. Seriously. You have to bite their heads off or something and their brains all come blech off. Yuck, that's nasty. I can't imagine.
They're like little lobsters.
No, they're not. Because when we were little, my brothers would go crawfish hunting down in the creeks and stuff. And that was just nasty to me. They just don't look healthy to me. Did you know that there's people over in Thailand that eat live octopuses and they'll kill you because you gag to death because the tentacles stick in your throat and gag you? Did you know that?
No, but fuck that.
Live octopus, and they take these baby octopi, I guess you call them, and they wrap them around a fork, and they dip them in this hot sauce, which is really sad, and then they start chewing them up, and these little tentacles stick on your teeth and all, and if you try to swallow one in one of their long arms, it'll gag you. Isn't that horrible?
My father gave me a bag of chowder mix he bought one time at Costco, and when I made chowder, it had all these little fucking octopus tentacles in it.
Oh my god, that's nasty.
That's fucking freaky. Like fucking, and I've been all, you know, I've eaten a lot of seafood in my life, but it was pretty freaky seeing the fucking.
I have an obsession with spiders. I have arachnophobia. I've never told that to anybody on my show before. I am arachnophobic.
Yeah, I'm not big on spiders, and I'm not big on snakes.
Snakes don't bother me as much as spiders. When I see spiders, I get physically ill when I see them. I'm so scared of them. And lobsters remind me of spiders, you know?
No, lobsters are delicious.
Not lobsters. I mean, octopus remind me of spiders. I'm sorry. I'm so tired.
Octopus are like really intelligent.
Yeah, they are. They can sneak out of a 1-inch by 1-inch thing, even though they're gigantic.
They have, like, there's some types of octopus that camouflage themselves. They have instant camouflage capabilities that are...
I know. All about that. I saw that YouTube video. Yes, I did.
Pretty amazing stuff.
Yeah, it is. You know that guy named Tyler I was talking about earlier? Sonny, he almost bought that house where that lady killed her husband and tried to bury him out, and it all got caught on closed-circuit television. And she just covered him up with some dirt and some rocks.
That's right, Sonny. Sonny said it right. Snakes can make a person hurt themselves. You're fucking right. You can snap yourself in fucking two. You see a snake down by your foot some quick. I don't even live where they're poisonous.
I was just sitting. I was just going to say, I was sitting in my bathroom one night, just sitting there not doing anything. And all of a sudden I looked and this snake just comes slinking into my bathroom. And I screamed and got up on top of the laboratory, you know, the sink, and screamed so loud I wouldn't stop screaming until Steven came all the way downstairs and got that snake out.
Yeah, fuck that. That's when I believe everybody should have a gun. You should just open up. You should be dialed to just open up when you see a snake. And if somebody gets hit with a stray bullet, well, that's just the price of killing a snake.
Yeah. My dad used to think that whenever we would go fishing with him, because I used to go fishing with my dad all the time, we had to be careful of water moccasins. He said they would jump out of the lake and get us. Is that true?
Well, I don't know, but I know they're very aggressive.
I've never seen one before, but he said, you stay away from those rocks, Deborah, or water moccasins going to jump out. And I was like, what? And you know how you always think your parents are stupid at that age? So I was like, and I never understood what he meant by that. I didn't know if it was true or not. Saturday. So I'm cleaning out all this crap for this garage sale today. And guess who comes walking up? None other than Jeff Coat, one of those Dallas sheriffs that used to fuck with my kids. And he was so nice. His last name was Jeff Coat. That's all I got. That's the only thing I knew about was Jeff Coat. He's an asshole. That was fun.
Fuck that.
Yeah, fuck him. So, Goose made an appearance on my show. Was it last night? Yeah. And he was so freaking funny. And I don't know why, for some reason. And I'm not kissing Goose's ass, because Goose and I have a very interesting relationship. And we have an ongoing relationship. It's never really died out. But last night, Goose was in absolute rare form. I mean, I haven't heard Goose like this in a long time. He was just the old Goose before he became the, you know, the mean kind of Goose, you know, kind of person. He was the old, laid-back, funny Goose. And if you didn't hear it, you should hear it. I don't know what it's called. It's just called something. But I think it was my show. Was it last night? I don't know. My nights are running together now.
Yeah, I've heard it be pretty funny. I've heard some stuff. It's really very funny.
Oh, this was funny for some reason. He was in a mood. He went and got this guy off of YouTube to be on my show, and the guy from YouTube was funny. And Goose and I get, I mean, he can take me back to where I feel like I'm, you know, like 18 again, and I start acting like, I don't know if I'm immature or what it is. No, I'm not immature because I take care of business, but I just really can get on anybody's level, and I just got right down. We just started acting stupid. It's really dumb.
But what I know, if I go to Michigan, I want to shoot an assault rifle. And I'm going to join the NRA.
Would you kill somebody?
No, but I figure if I go to Michigan, I might as well become a Republican.
You know, they say when... I just forgot what you said. Republican. Do you ever want to be an American?
No.
Really?
I've been pretty proud all my life of the fact that I'm Canadian, and you know, believe it or not, us Canadians, we like Canada.
I totally agree. I there's a lot of people that are saying that if Hillary Clinton wins, they're going to leave the country. A lot of people are seriously saying that.
Well, aren't they the same people that said they were going to leave if Obama won?
I don't know. I wasn't paying that much attention to that race. I thought Mitt Romney was going to get it.
Yeah.
I really did. I thought that somebody cheated. Didn't Obama cheat something out of Mitt Romney really bad during that race? Something happened with Obama.
Yeah.
What was
it? Yeah, he got more votes.
Oh, come on. No, right at the very end, he pulled out some old information on Romney or something and blew him out of the race. No. What was it?
Yeah, his record.
Uh-oh.
Mitt Romney probably, truth to be told, me and Barker were talking about this last night, Mitt Romney probably would have been more liberal in a lot of his policies than Barack Obama was.
Did you like Barack Obama, or do you like Barack Obama?
Well, what you guys, like the Democrat Party in the States would be a conservative party anywhere else in the world. You know that, don't you?
I'd have to be convinced of it, but okay.
No, that's true. Like, if you took the policies of the Democratic Party of the United States and went to England and then had a political party that had those same policies, it would be a conservative party in England.
All right, give me five qualities of a true Democrat versus five qualities of a true Republican, or just give me three each.
What, of modern or of the definition?
Well, what you think it means to be Democrat?
Well, the core belief of the Republican Party, as far as I can tell, is that they believe in trickle down economics. They believe in low tax rates for business and for high income earners, and then they in turn will share that wealth with those people that benefit from their business and their investments, right? And they don't believe in government regulations. They believe in small government and that. Whereas the Democrats are the opposite. They believe in like labor unions, and they believe in government regulation. You get what I mean?
Well, I've always looked at it as one of them is actually government of the people, and one of them is government by the people, and one of them is government for the people. Now, I know that's not really the way that sentence has been played out in the past. It's been played out altogether. But I've always kind of kept my liberal versus, you know, the left and the right and the middle would be one of them is government for the people, one of them is by the people, and one of them is for the people, by the people, and of the people. Yeah, right. One of them is more like almost like a communistic approach. One of them is more like a Democrat, democracy, and one of them is like just liberal, a libertarian viewpoint. And I'm actually more libertarian than I am anything, to be honest with you.
Cool.
So I really think he is going to prosecute Hillary Clinton. And I did not think that until I was sitting out there eating my steak.
Well, I seen something there not too long ago, an hour or so ago, where they're saying that none of the emails come from the private server. That any of the emails that he's got on his computer, that Wiener's got, none of them come from her private server. They all come from so where did I see that?
Okay, but that's not what they're mad about. What are they doing on his, on their computer, which can be hacked?
Well, that would be a security breach on his end, not hers. Like, if she sent emails to him and he was, you know, she was, like, sending emails to him and where he opened them, like, she can't help where he opened them. And it would only be a breach if she sent something to him that she wasn't supposed to send. Right?
I guess. I don't know. I don't know. Nobody knows what it is yet.
Well, I don't know either, but I've seen something there earlier. They're saying that none of the emails come from her private server. So.
Well, what got me that Comey said is he said, I will not be publicly humiliated like I was last summer. And he said, that's not going to happen. So that told me he is going to move forward with prosecution. The FBI is. And if that happens, there's no way she could be the president of this country.
Well,
I don't know. We'll see. But I do like the way the mainstream media is cleaning up their act and they're getting called out for the bullshitters that they've done to this country. I think that is deplorable.
I know. Like, they haven't been fair to Trump at all.
No. They haven't.
I know. Like, hardly gets any coverage. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah. Like, trust me, I know what you mean.
I know. Like he's never, like, hardly ever in front of a camera. They never ever report anything that he says.
Well, if they do, they say that he's a racist, or he's this, or he's that, or he's this, or he's that, and they just say that he's horrible. And they don't say that with Hillary Clinton. They just say, well, she made an executive decision that was not well. You know, they word things weird, and I just saw them getting called out on it. But it has just come to my attention that my mom, I'm now calling her my mother, Judge Jeanine Pirro, has just put out a brand new opening statement. Would you like to hear it with me for the first time?
Sure.
This just came out. It was released 3 hours ago. Here we go. It's about Comey. Why do I say Comey? All right. Go on mute. I'm going to go on mute. Here we go with the new... Hit your mute button. I'm going to hit my mute button. Ready?
Yep.
You didn't hit your mute button.
We're
gonna stick a frigger goddamn Debbie mute button.
I can't find it. There we go.
There we go. Here we go. Opening statement.
Clinton responds to the FBI's reopening of her case. Hello and welcome to Justice. I'm Judge Jeanine Pirro. Thanks for being with us. We'll hear from Clinton and Donald Trump in a moment. Plus, Rudy Giuliani is here, as is Trump campaign manager Kellyanne Conway. But first, my opening statement. FBI Director Jim Comey's announcement yesterday that he would again look into Hillary Clinton's emails after he announced on July 5th the conclusion of that very investigation, saying no reasonable prosecutor would indict 11 days before one of the most hotly contested presidential elections of our time, both disgraces and politicizes the FBI, and is symptomatic of all that is wrong in Washington.
Jojo, you unmuted.
Oops, I didn't mean to.
I love you, Joe. Okay, ready?
10. Now, you know I support Donald Trump, and I want him to win. But whether it's Hillary Clinton or anyone else, Comey's actions violate not only longstanding Justice Department policy, the directive of the person that he works under, the Attorney General, but even more important, the most fundamental rules of fairness and impartiality. 10 years ago, when I was the Republican conservative candidate for New York Attorney General, in the home stretch of a statewide campaign, the Justice Department and the FBI violated their own policy against making public statements that would affect an election and announced to the press that they were opening an investigation of me. It was mean-spirited, and of course, nothing came of it. Except the adverse publicity cost me at the polls. What was done to me in 2006 was wrong, and what happened to Hillary Clinton yesterday was equally wrong. The Justice Department and the FBI's policy to not comment publicly about politically sensitive investigations within 60 days of an election exists for a very important reason. Announcements so close to elections have an impact. Now, this nation has already gone through an exhausting and traumatic campaign season. The FBI director should not now be front and center. One of the most revered agencies in our nation's history, now seen as putting its finger on the scales of justice, should not now be front and center. So why did he do it? Some say Comey didn't have a choice because he said to Congress that the investigation was over. Wrong. I read that testimony. Others suggest a mutiny at the FBI was underway because the investigation was never real. Maybe he feared local police involvement, the New York City Police Department, in the pedophile investigation on the Uba Abedin and Anthony Weiner computer might have leaked that the first investigation simply was not thoroughly investigated. Maybe he felt guilty, needing a second bite at the apple. and 11 days before an election? How is it that he sends a letter to Congress? He could simply have gotten a ranking member of the committee and that member's deputy and told him, and then said, if this gets out, I'll know that you did it. But it doesn't matter now. Had Comey done his job in the first place? Had he done a real investigation? Had he issued one subpoena, sought one search warrant? Had a grand jury been impaneled? Had he and the DOJ not granted immunity to every Tom, Dick, and Harry, and Uma, and everybody else who walked through his office? Had they not destroyed the laptops of those without clearance to handle our nation's top secrets? We wouldn't be in this mess. Now, Hillary Clinton should have been indicted a long time ago. She and Bill's scandals have done nothing but soil this great nation's image. It's long past time for both of them to start paying for their wrongdoings. And on tonight's show, we're going to talk about how the Clintons have again brought us to the precipice of a constitutional crisis. The reality of a presidential candidate under investigation by the FBI. And what happens if she is elected and then indicted? Who can pardon her? Can she pardon herself? And if not pardons, can she be impeached for a crime committed before she was in office? Thanks to the Clintons, here we go again. And that's my open.
Comments, Joe?
Wow, She sounded very fair and balanced.
Fair and balanced.
what am I supposed to say to that, Debbie? That
I don't know.
You know, okay, some angry old white fucking Republican lady that lost an election in New York, you know, still holds a grudge against the Democrats and holds some strong opinions against the Democratic presidential candidate. That's what I got to say. Do I agree with what she's saying? No, it sounds like Rush Limbaugh in a dress. So.
Yeah, she's pretty. I don't know. I just like the way she hits hard and she doesn't mince words. That's what I like about her. I like that she says what she. I mean, we're all entitled to our own opinion, and she's.
Oh no! Like you got to give her that. Like she certainly, you know, she's certainly very articulate and. And really, you know, big, you know, cuts to the bone. Yeah, she's certainly skilled at what she does. Like you got to give her credit where credit's due. But
you know, so. I don't know how this deal's going to work out. I really don't know.
I do.
Hillary Clinton's going to be the next president.
And who told you? Who told you a year ago?
You. And I believe that because of the electoral.
And what did I say? What did I say was going to be the reason why he was going to lose?
His mouth.
Who did I say wouldn't vote for him?
Yeah, you're right.
I said women. The shit's going to come out about him and women, and it ain't going to be good. You remember?
Well, it's like voting in the class of, you know, the guy that hates women, you know, that kind of, I mean, I can't tell how he feels about women. I mean, he's just a male chauvinist. There's no doubt about it. I mean,
he's like one of the Mad Men type men.
Yeah, you know, from
the fucking 50s and 60s living in 2016.
I've never heard that. That is excellent.
Still slaps chicks on the ass and fucking, you know what I mean? And calls them toots and fucking.
Yeah, he says if his daughter wasn't his daughter, he would date her.
And I'd thought, nail that. I'd nail that.
I'll buy that for a dollar.
I think in his own, I don't think in his defense, and I don't like to defend him, but I think in that interview where he said that, I don't think he was saying he wanted to fuck his daughter. I think in his way, that was he was Donald Trump in the fact that my daughter's beautiful, right? But it came across as he's saying, I want to fuck my daughter. That's not what he was saying.
Well, but the mainstream media was twisting everything. They really were, Joe.
I really do believe what he was saying was, is my daughter's beautiful. Look at her. You know what I mean? If she wasn't my daughter, I'd marry her. Type deal. Like, I don't think he was saying, oh, look at my daughter. I want to when she sleeps at night, I touch her hair, you know, and fucking shit like that. No, but you know, and listen, I'm not don't try to make excuses for Donald Trump, because he went after fucking people the whole time through the primaries, and he cut people apart over nothing. You know what I mean? Like, fucking, he made up barefaced lies and just fucking said.
Did he really?
Said Ted Cruz's father killed fucking Kennedy.
Well, he said he was pictured there or something like that. I thought that was a little bit strange.
He's crazy, man. He spreakered the presidential candidate. Like, he trolled.
He spreakered the
RNC, man. He really did. He spreakered them all. Poor Jeb Bush.
How do you... Oh, I know. That was sad. I felt sorry for him, almost. Because he seems like a normal Bush, the only normal Bush in the bunch. The only normal bunch of the Bush. The only one that's normal.
Well, he's the one that they all thought was going to be president anyway before fucking George.
Really? Is he older? He's the youngest, isn't he?
I believe so. I believe he's older than George.
I didn't know that. I don't know. I want to ask y'all a weird question, and I'm just going to say something. I want to get your first response. When I say a word, you say something back. Okay, you ready?
Here we go.
The Masons.
Secretive, I guess.
Evil?
Don't know. I don't know enough about them.
I know. Well, somebody very close to me has been invited into the Masons.
Well, it's not hard to get into the Masons, but there's many layers to the Masons.
Yeah, there's like a million layers in the Masons. It had become this and that and this and that and this and that.
I was inside a Mason's Lodge one time. You ever been inside one?
My grandfather was a Mason, but no.
Were you ever inside the meeting lodge?
No, sir. I never have been.
It was freaky.
They don't have windows. No,
and they've got all these freaky big wooden chairs on all, like, the north, south, east, west, and sides of the room. And it's all about, like, different officers within the lodge sitting in each chair. Mm-hmm. And each chair has a light bulb in the armrest. Mm-hmm. In the inside of the light bulb, the glass part where the filament wire is.
Mm-hmm.
It's shaped like the Mason's symbol, like the fucking compass and the ship.
Yeah, the compass and the ruler.
Uh-huh. In the carpet, like it's pretty fucking, it's pretty trippy when you're in there and you really start looking around and you start realizing just how much Mason stuff, symbolism and stuff there is in absolutely everything in the room.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty.
But the Masons also, they won't let a brother, it's just, to me, it's like a fraternity almost, and they will not let a brother lose his mortgage, they won't let, you know, if he's, you know, they're always there to take care of each other, but I think that's kind of...
Well, that's true, that's not so, you know, like, yes and no, I guess.
That's what I've heard. Or maybe that's the older days or something. I don't know if they change over time.
I think that's not so much now, I don't think.
Yeah,
but the Masons, there's nobody in politics that's not a Mason.
Yep. I know that. And they actually created Washington, D.C. to look like the Mason thing, like the stars.
Well, there was a lot of speculation
Yeah, I could say my block looks like that, so that's kind of stupid. But I don't know. I mean, would you join the Masons? If you had an opportunity
Fuck no.
Why
all the guys I know that are Masons in my hometown are all dicks.
Yeah, I don't know. It's interesting. I don't know. Is anybody in my chat room talking about it? I need feedback for this because...
I'm moving to Michigan anyway and going to fucking hook up a Barco sister. Going to drive a tractor for Barco, $12 an hour U.S. under the table.
Debbie says there is no demonic rights of any of that shit, he says. And he says it's just old... I'm looking off the board. Let me go find my chat room. I hate the board. It's too little. There we go. I found it.
the whole thing about the Masons, it's a system. It's sort of like a church system set up, but it's designed to figure out who's trustworthy and who's not. And everything about the Masons is about secrets, you know, being able to keep a secret. And when you get into the Masons, the first thing they teach you is the handshake. And you're never, ever supposed to show it to anybody that's not a fellow member. Right? And there's always another level of secret, you know. So you could be like a Mason for 40 years, and there'd be whole other groups within your Masons that you don't even know about. Because as you prove yourself to higher ups, you know what I mean, and you're useful, they will give you access to more. You know what I mean? And those are the guys.
Barco so smart? What makes Barco? I heard every word you said, Angel, but I'm reading the chat room as you're speaking, but I did hear everything you were talking about. Why does Barco appear so smart? Is Barco that smart?
Well, I think a big reason why Barco's probably smart is Barco grew up on a farm and probably did a lot of reading as a kid.
Is he college educated?
I think so.
I mean, he said, I like the way his wording, he words things right. Not right, but he does. I'm reading what the comments are, and I haven't been keeping up with them, but they're really giving some good comments. Like Sonny says, I would like to see Biden and Trump square off in the geezer battle. Yeah, they will be calling it ours for its overstabby. He says,
"You know, I feel sorry for
who?
Donald Trump's wife."
Yeah, I know. I do too.
Because you know that poor sweet piece of ass just isn't getting it right.
Yeah.
There ain't no way Donald Trump's fucking that right. There's no way.
Barco said that Apocalypse is the disabled Walmart employee that the manager sends out to the corral carts in the parking lot so the rest of the employees can laugh at the gimp. That's horrible.
You know what? Fuck that. When I worked at the fucking mall when I was young, and I had to go gather carts, I had to push the fuckers. Them guys at Walmart got this battery fucking thing that pushes them for them. Like, what the fuck is that? I had to push them fuckers for the slush.
Absolutely. We have that. We have that in Walmart. Some of the Walmarts have that.
Do you know what it's like trying to push 20 shopping carts through slush?
Do you?
Yes.
No, you don't.
That's why I quit.
No,
That's why I fucking quit.
Don't. You liar, pants on fire. Now,
I worked at the mall when I was young.
The 2028 election will be between George P. Bush and Chelsea Clinton. Okay.
I can't wait till fucking Michelle Obama's the fucking president.
I don't know.
You know if Hillary Clinton wins, she could appoint Barack Obama to the Supreme Court.
I know. I've been thinking about that. Can she really do that?
Yeah, she could. She really could.
And would she do that? And if so, why?
Well, it's, you know, why not?
I don't know. I just don't like some of his policies and stuff. I just don't. I just think that he is... I just think he's helped push some of this ISIS stuff.
Well, Debbie, you know, you can either fight it or you can accept it, and I think you should just accept your Muslim overlords.
Right. I suppose, yeah. I guess. I don't know. Obama's never really done anything that's hurt me personally, I guess. Gunner, go away. Stop it. Why are my dogs getting all bejibbity right now? Why are y'all...
Think of how hot you'd look in a burqa with those pretty eyes of yours.
Yeah, you could be right. Everybody says I look good when I have a towel on my head. Stop it, Gunner.
Just put one hand like up to your over your face, like up to your nose, mm-hmm. And then the other one across your forehead, and just look at yourself in the mirror, and just look at your eyes. You'll see.
Well, stop it, Fufu. Gunner, and they're on their feet now. They've slept, and they're now on their feet. And I'm going, what do you guys need right now? What is it, Gunner?
Because I just figure when you're like, see Muslim women and they all got them burqas on, I just figure they're all hot. I just assume they're all hot.
Yeah, there was a comedic duo named Gunner, stop it. He's trying to knock me off my chair. What are you doing, Goofy? Stop it. He's got his gigantic head right here by me. Hi. And Key and Peele did a thing where they were wolf whistling the women in burkas. Stop it, Fufu. And every time they would say, wow, strong ankles and stuff like that. I don't
strong
know.
Ankles.
And it's just stupid. It was really funny.
Marcus, a buddy of mine, you know those fucking Con Air fucking hair trimmer things you can buy?
Uh-huh.
The round ones that you're supposed to be able to do your own hair, even?
Oh, wait. Now, are you talking about with the vacuum cleaner, a Floby?
Nope. This thing, they sell them. They're round. And they're supposed to be like a hair trimmer that you can do your own hair and do it even. So a buddy of mine gave me one a couple days ago. He said, here, you can have this. It's fucking junk. And I tried to do my hair with it this morning. Holy fuck, I cut myself all to hell.
Aw, Joe.
I feel like I was fighting. Holy fuck.
You feel like you were fighting. I don't know. What does it look like? I don't understand. I mean, I've never heard of it. What is it?
It's a... It's hard to explain. It's about as... it's a little bit bigger than your hand.
Right.
And it's round.
Round. Okay, stop right there. What do you mean round? Like a ball round? Like a tennis ball?
Sort of. It's round, but it's got like blades in the bottom of it, but it's like dome-shaped.
Mm-hmm.
And you're supposed to put it on your head and just go around and it cuts your hair to the even length. Well, all it did to me was fucking cut me. Pulled my hair out by the root.
What's it called?
Con Air Even Trim or something.
Do you have a Roomba? We have a Roomba. We have two Roombas, and one of them is... Roombas are really badass. If anybody can get a Roomba, you can get them cheap on Craigslist and stuff. Y'all know what's really even funnier than that? Hold on, I got to sit up. I was laying down talking to Joe. Y'all know who Sleep the God is, right? Does anybody know who Sleep the God is? Have you ever heard of Sleep the God? Sleep the God is a... He's, for all practical purposes, a troll, but he's also a master hacker. And I mean, he is a master hacker. No. He is. He's a master hacker. Sleep the God is the one that actually 100% DDoSed my show about a year ago. Do y'all remember when I got DDoSed off the air 4 times in a row and I kept coming back and back and back and back and he was sending packets to me? Do you remember that? Maybe you don't.
I remember.
Well, Sleep the God tweeted me today a private message. He goes, seriously, Debbie, do you have any laptops for sale? And I said, actually, I've got two. I've got one over here that I could let go and... I'm going to sell Sleep the God a laptop.
He'll probably get in a bunch of your old info.
Oh, no, I'm going to wipe it. I'm going to clean it before he goes. It'll be totally empty. But
you'll see the sexy movies you made for Vic.
I don't make sexy movies for Vic.
Neither do I. That's something else we have in common.
What?
I don't make sexy movies for Vic either.
Yeah, well, but how ironic. Isn't that ironic? That I would sell Sleep to God a laptop.
Yeah.
Turnabout. It's fair play, I guess. I don't know. I think he's a nice kid. He's African American, and he's.
Well, he'd fit right in around Spreaker, though.
He was in my chat under. Are you talking to me, Stabby? He was in a chat under your name with a terrible spelling and grammar. Who? Oh, Victor or Sleep to God? Oh, Victor. Debbie Vic was snooping around on your account last night. Well, I don't think it's so much. There's nothing to snoop around on the account. I do know that he was on my name. He talked to Jerry last night. When they got off the air, he said they talked for 2 more hours. Is that true? Or was it an hour? He didn't know.
I'd like to watch Vic and the One Angry Jew like have a fight club type fight.
He can't stand him. Most men can't stand the One Angry Jew.
No, I just think it'd be fun to watch that, like on YouTube. Like a fight club type thing with Vic and the One Angry Jew.
He was snooping. What was he? Where was he posting? How did you know he was on there? I mean, how do you know that, Stabby? What did he tell you? Please, get out of town. He didn't tell you anything, Apocalypse. What would he tell you? There's nothing to tell. Is there? No.
I wasn't here, so I don't know.
Yeah. Well, the One Angry Jew, when I was on Blog Talk Radio, anybody that came up on my show, and I mean, this is years ago, Joe, years ago, anybody that you always had to bow his shoulders back and show him that he was a smarter than they were, or he just always seemed to, it was just weird with him. But then he'll act like he hates me, but then anybody that comes at me, he's like Gunner with Fufu. Like, if anybody comes around Gunner and Fufu, Gunner will sudden, you know, bow up real big, and he'll like get away from Fufu, you know, like. And it's just, I know that sounds kind of stupid, I guess that is a bad example, but that's the way the Jew has always done my podcast. And even a long time ago on Blog Talk Radio, he went up against the same thing. He went up against the entire Skype assholes on a debate, trying to prove that he was smarter and all this kind of stuff. And it was interesting to listen to, because I was the moderator, and I would make one of them go on mute as one of them waited on the other one to do this, that, and the other. And stop. I'm sorry. And it was a pretty fair debate, but I believe that at the end of it all went to Snake of the Sky Basils, the winner, you know, being the winner and stuff like that. So I'm just saying, I don't know.
Snake.
Yeah. Wow. He goes by the moniker of Snake Plissken. And for short, we call him Snake. But it was pretty interesting.
I knew a black guy named Snake in Amherst.
Really?
Used to sell acid at the Golden Q.
Have you ever done acid?
All kinds of it.
Really?
Yeah. Really.
What does acid make you feel like? Is it like real strong marijuana?
No. No, it's nothing like marijuana.
What's it like? I'm not being funny either. I'm being honest. I'm being totally honest.
It's, fuck, I don't know what you could really compare it to. It's like putting everything in the world, in slow motion.
Mm-hmm.
And speeding everything else up around it.
But can't you have a bad situation on it too, right? I mean, is that true, or is that just all bullshit?
Well, I'm sure back in the 60s when they were making the window pane and stuff, I'm sure it was worse than what it is now. But I never ever had a bad time on it.
I would be too scared of that. That just seems a little bit too much for me. You know? I just don't think I could do that. It would just be too much. Just scared me to death or something. I don't know.
The only drug I ever had put in front of me that I did take, that I turned down, was meth.
That's amazingly addicting. I can't do that because of my regular heartbeat, but I had a...
everything else that was ever put in front of me, I did.
I had a boyfriend that did it, and he completely morphed into a different person when he was on it. It was bizarre. Anyway, yeah, he did. It was like, I could tell the minute he walked into the room if he was on that stuff. He loved that stuff. Well, they said...
Now, remember the other night? Well, I guess it was a couple weeks ago now, but Sonny was talking about how he ate some marijuana cookies or some candies, and he got all fucked up.
Yeah, that was funny.
Well, there's a reason for that, eh? You know that, don't you?
What is that? What do you mean, what is that?
When you smoke marijuana, like, depending on how you consume THC, it affects your body different. So when you smoke it, you take it through your lungs, and it you get the THC. When you eat it, you absorb it through your liver, and I'm not good with chemical names, but it produces another chemical in your liver, which is like more powerful of a of a stimulant than THC is. So it's more of a, you see more things and shit. It's more of a trippy high than what smoking it is. You know what I mean?
Maybe it metabolizes different or something.
Yeah.
Is that what it is, but or what?
When you eat it, your body processes it different, and it creates different chemicals in your body than what it does when you smoke it. The same as if you're taking it for medicinal purposes, like cancer treatment. You know what I mean? Say like oil.
Yeah, yeah, gonna do I it do.
Rick Simpson oil.
Right.
Yeah. You're supposed to take that through suppositories.
Really?
Yeah.
Why?
Because when you smoke it, you're burning it, and you're destroying a lot of the good medical qualities.
Yeah.
And when you eat it, you digest it, and you do the same thing. Whereas if you take it through a suppository, you get it all.
Don't you think that people that claim that they're so addicted to smoking meth, aren't they just addicted to smoking like smokers are?
Well, yeah, because it's a chemical dependency.
Well, right? I mean, think about it. You know, there's people that can do that stuff, and because I had a sister-in-law that did that stuff, but she would take it and wrap it in a little piece of paper towel, and she would swallow it, because she gave it to me one time, and we were going to go skiing, and I thought I was going to die.
Well, there's different...
Joe.
Yeah, I'm here. I'm still here.
Yeah, okay. I'm sorry.
Like, eating meth is different than smoking meth. And start, you know what I mean? Like, again, it's the same thing again.
Well,
if you eat it.
She was, like, really skinny and stuff, and she used it as diet medicine. Diet medication is what she called it.
Yeah, well, you know, a lot of people do. It's when you get smoking it, just like cocaine. Right? You can start cocaine pretty well forever, but
as soon as you get smoking, you're fucked. But I'm saying, don't you just get addicted to the smoking, just like somebody gets addicted to smoking a cigarette.
Well, you get addicted to the act of, you know, the act of compound within the meth, yeah. So, and you get addicted to smoking cigarettes because of nicotine.
Yeah, but if that's true, why can't you just take something another form of nicotine, like the patch?
You can.
But it never works for anybody.
It works for all kinds of people.
You know, I noticed at the fair the other day that nobody smokes anymore. Nobody. You used to smoke, didn't you?
Yeah, I sure did.
I remember you smoking when I would listen to your show.
No, no.
What were you all...
Not ever.
Well, maybe it was somebody else, but when did you quit? A long, long, long time ago?
Yeah, before I started podcasting.
Do you ever think about it?
Once in a while.
My daughter quit smoking over a year ago, and it still drives her nuts.
Well, it's because it's a habit thing.
She says she misses the breaks. The time that she spent alone going outside, you know, I'm just going to get out away from this house, these kids and everything, and I'm just going to go have a cigarette. She goes, that's what she misses.
See, when I had my restaurant,
mm-hmm.
The last year I was open, when people would come in for a job interview,
mm-hmm.
you weren't allowed to ask them if they smoked or not. So how I used to do it, I smoked, right? So I used to say, about halfway through the interview, I used to say, well, I'm just going to slip out real quick for a cigarette. Do you want to come? Right? And any smoker will take the opportunity to go, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if they were a smoker, I'd never hire them.
Wow, that's pretty smart.
You never want smokers in the restaurant business, I'm telling you.
So do you want to hear a little bit of the Jew versus the Skype assholes? I found it.
Sure, why not?
All right, if you'll hit mute, I'll play some of it. I'll just skip around, and I'll just because I know what you want to hear. How he would argue, really argue a 911. It's over 911, of course. That's all he ever argues.
I know. I love stressing him out about it.
I know. All right, you ready? I'll play some of it. Here we go. From the year 512 of 2011 off my show on Blogstock Radio, here is the Jew versus the Skype assholes. Or...
And, we had a little situation come up over here about, I don't know how long ago, I think it was last Saturday night or something, maybe the one before that. No, it was actually Saturday night, when two of the most, in my opinion, powerful rivals on BTR, which would be the One Angry Jew and Snake Plissken of the infamous the Skype Assholes, sort of went toe-to-toe in my chat room and on my show actually, and Snake was called out by the Jew to a debate on whether or not what took place on 9/11 of 2001. I don't mind. I'm going to put one quick song on and be back and get. I mean, how will we judge the winner? What do you think about that?
Well, you know, I don't think there's really going to be a winner or a loser, because really you don't have a set of judges. You don't have a panel. You don't have somebody who's asking the questions.
This is true.
And I don't even know if there are any questions, because it's going to be
which angle he's going to take. He's going to take the conspiracy that's been happening here the last 100 years with the Gulf of Tonkin, the government, not be trusted, and false flags, and the we trained Bin Laden to come over here and intentionally kill 3,000 people in the towers, and then all the people in the airplanes that died that day. So we need to know which angle he's going to take. The long-term conspiratorial one, or the one that it was carried out through three presidential administrations, starting under Bill Clinton to George Bush, now to Barack Obama, to intentionally kill people on American soil, our government. All right, and that's it. All right,
there
you go.
I have
you.
I'm here. No, I'm
all right. Now, let's see what this dude does. He'll start complaining. He'll start complaining. Plus, he doesn't know how a refrigerator works.
All right, stand by. That was for just information's sake. That was 1 minute, 25 seconds. Hang on just a second. Let me see what he says. All right, Jew, what do you say about that? I consider it habit.
I wasn't even listening to him. Frankly, look, I don't care. He's going to make an opening statement of 5 minutes.
That
I'm giving it to him.
That was his opening statement?
Well, that was just a bunch of questions. That wasn't a statement. Okay. So here's the thing. If that was his opening statement, then I will make my opening statement, and you can be sure that I will use all 5 minutes. And then we will go back and forth. Now, I will make a statement. He can ask. He doesn't get to know what it is that I'm going to say prior to what I'm going to say it, because I frankly don't care what he's going to say prior to when I hear it. When I hear it, I'll deal with it. When he hears it, he can deal with what I say. So I hope we're done with Yura and everybody else. I hope they're all over. It's just Snake and me now.
Oh, there was Yura. I forgot to tell you this, Joe. Yura comes on. Yura was a former Russian. He was a former Russian KGB, and Yura was with me on Skype. And Jew felt that I was in cahoots with Yura, and I was not. All Yura was doing was making sure that he had me on a Skype call to make sure that I was not Skyping with the Jew. And it was really kind of interesting. This was really serious. There were hundreds of people in this chat room that night. And I'll skip around. But if you wanted to hear the part he was talking about Yura, I'll go back and let you hear Yura talk, because Yura was 100% Russian, and he was really a serious guy. The Skype assholes they were very intimidating. I know exactly what Snake did for a living. He is in retirement right now. I know where he lives. I know everything about him. And I know what most of them do, and they were not just choir boys. They were a group of guys that were altogether somewhat powerful. And the Jew, I believe, in my honest opinion, I'm going to be honest, I never said this before, I believe that the Jew wanted to be part of the Skype assholes. And then they rejected him because he's an asshole. And that sounds kind of stupid, but anyway. Let me see if I can pick up where Yura was on. Here we go.
King of the Jews.
We're here to debate whether or not 9/11 was an inside job. And I'll define an inside job for you. I'll define it at its least, and I'll define it for talking about. I don't need a show prep. I don't need to prep for anything. I know this stuff cold. All the silliness about, do I know this? Do I know nuclear physics? You know, I'm ignoring all of that.
It looks like I see one of them on the board. Stand by. And bring them on. Guys, I swear to God, I've got to go get something on. I'm sitting here in a towel.
All right. Question number one for the Jew. Does he know how a refrigerator works?
Mm-hmm.
And number two, did he pass physical chemistry on a college level?
We're here to debate whether or not.
Are we going to participate in the decision on how the rules are going to go?
Okay, here's Yura. Yura was really, really worried about this. And Yura was with me. He's on my Skype call with me. Let's go back just a wee bit. Here we go.
I mean, how will we judge the winner? What do you think about that?
Well, you know, I don't think there's really going to be a winner or a loser, because really you don't have a set of judges. You don't have a panel. You don't have somebody who's asking the questions.
This is true.
And I don't even know if there are any questions, because it's going to be...
And I'm at onlinestopwatch.com, just so everybody knows I'm keeping it fair. And I'll be watching back and forth at the little stopwatch. So let me go and see what's up with Snake. Snake, did you hear any of all that?
Are we going to participate in the decision on how the rules are going to go? Because it seems like
absolutely.
You and the Jew over there.
That's why I'm
set
here.
Up the rules now.
No.
Changed since we last talked, right? Snake already asked the question, right? You
that's
did let him ask the question, and then you let the Jew Google the answer in the meantime while you went to get dressed.
That has nothing to do
with it. Well, that's what happened.
Don't talk over me. That has nothing to do with the 911
debate. Baseline of what I'm dealing with, all right?
It has nothing to do with the 911 debate, whether or not he has a refrigerator or
work. It has everything to do with the debate, Debbie. The thing is, until you hear the answer, you don't know that. You can't prejudge the guy's question. That has everything to do with what this guy is going to argue against Snake. Everything.
Right. Does he know how a refrigerator works? And did he pass P chemistry in college? Physical?
Joe, do you know how a refrigerator works?
Yeah, you put stuff in it and it gets cold.
That's what I would say, too. All right, let's go back.
Chemistry, that's it. Then I know where I'm going to come out.
I'm
not coming out with some guy who's just...
You know, you're on somebody.
All right.
Let
me
take
it back. Hang on, let me go back to him and see what's going on. All right, Jew.
First of all, as far as I'm concerned, this debate has started. Now, I don't want to hear any of these other assholes. And I say assholes, I don't say that in a nice way. I don't want to hear any of them. I don't want to hear anybody but Snake. I don't want to hear any of them negotiating, because you should not be negotiating with anybody but Snake. So if these people stay on the line, I'm gone, I'm out of here, he's done, he forfeits. Now, if he wants to shut them all up and get rid of them, if he wants to go one-on-one with me, if he wants to show that he's got a set of gonads between his legs and take me on without all the other help and all the other... They're gonna argue now.
They're ganging up on me now.
It's ridiculous.
It sounds like they're ganging up on me now.
Well,
you know,
of course. That's of course. They've got to go. They've got to go or it's done, because I won't play this game with him. He loses... And forevermore, where everybody's going to say, he came in here, he forfeited the rules, he's done. He doesn't get to argue with
now
me.
Their contention is that they don't get to have any say-so in the rules.
Oh, no, we agreed on the rules on Saturday, if you recall.
And that is on, let me go back, stand by. Snake?
Debbie, you again gave us an opportunity to ask a question, and then the Jew again did not, and he went on another topic. On more of the rule bullshit, right? And he's not. He said, as far as I'm concerned, the debate has started. And then he continued to talk about the rules of the debate, okay? Even though the debate has started.
Stand by. Jew?
Look, we agreed. We're going to have opening statements. I don't want to hear Yura. I don't want to hear your...
You
know what? I don't want to hear Yura. I want to hear Snake. If Snake is... Okay, I'll tell you what. If Snake is not man enough to take me on, then let him substitute Yura, and I'll debate Yura. If he wants to admit that he's not man enough to take me on by himself, or he doesn't have the intellect, whatever it is, I'll debate Yura. Or I'll debate Falcon. I don't care, but I'm debating one person, not two, not three, not four.
Fair enough, Snake.
Oh, well, baby, I asked him two crummy questions. That was my opening statement.
Snake, that's not what we're talking about. Mute Snake so I can talk to Snake. Snake, that's not what we're talking about. We're not talking about whether or not you ask questions. We're trying to lay some ground rules. I mean, that even goes in sandlot baseball. I mean, I'm not ganging up on anybody. I'm just trying to be an even Steven moderator here, okay?
Let me tell you something. There's not one other person that would put the Skype assholes like that on hold. I mean, that is literally taking control of somebody that could crush you. These men... could have literally blown my computer sky high if they wanted to. That's the capacity that they had. They could have made life rough for me. And I was telling them to shut the fuck up and put them on hold in mid-sentence. And that's where I got the reputation of what I was, which was I had, you know, a lot of umspa is what they used to say about me. That's just what people said. Unless you were the idiots that are like, oh, she's trying to get my children or something. All right. If I think we're already almost halfway there. I think, Joe, if I remember correctly, and other guys, as in, that the debate never really went on because the Jew and Snake and whoever, they were just going back and forth about bullshit. And what is it about a refrigerator? And it has something to do with the heating coils or something. And it's really an odd way that it or something. But they were making most of them are work in the field as engineers, and they were well, you know what I'm saying, without giving out too much information, because it's kind of like a secret society over there too. But it's like, you know what I mean? It's like they were adamant about that. And because they were saying, you know, Snakes, or Yura told me in private that if Jew could explain how a refrigerator worked, that would mean what happened or something. I don't know what it, I forgot now. Should I just let some more of it play? Shut the fuck up, Debbie.
Yeah, sure. Let it play. I don't care. But yeah.
All right. We'll let a little bit more of it play.
He's right. There's got to be some kind of ground rules. If he's going to show up to a fight with you and him, and you've got a gang with you, that's not going to be level. And I'm not taking up for him. You know that. I don't take up for anybody. So, you know what I mean?
No. Right. Here's the opening statement. It ain't going to take 5 minutes. We need to know which angle one-eyed Jew's taking. The Illuminati, Federal Reserve, inside job view, CIA trained agents in Afghanistan. The people are still alive on the airplanes. The airplanes didn't really hit them, were the ones that took off. Was it CIA Great Goose, remote controlled, and...
Okay, now I just remembered. Snake and them were saying exactly what other people have said. The only thing that the Jew comes with is theory. He just says it's sort of like an Illuminati type theory, you know, the, you know, 911's inside job. And they come with bold facts of the case, and they weren't going to argue it. So I'm going to skip forward. I'm going to skip way forward. Okay, here I go.
Was there really a plan? I'm skipping way forward.
2 minutes and 47 seconds. And back over to the switchboard. All right, Mr. Pliskin, hang on just 1 second, sweetie. I will, hold on. And you're back on the air.
Well, he's just giving you all conjecture there, man, just making an absolute fool of himself. Now, Building 1, as we know, was hit fully loaded. It was pretty high up, and there was pretty big fire, Debbie, and he's going after this side that diesel fuel or kerosene doesn't burn or isn't hot enough to melt the beams in the liquid steel, but it sure is hot enough to make the beams be weakened, and weaken their tensile strength, and then the load on the building, because these steel columns and steel beams, I-beams, would have been weakened significantly and couldn't handle the load on them above
Fahrenheit. Let me say that again, 549 degrees Fahrenheit. So let's go to the second link that I put in there from that engineering toolbox. I'm sure I could pick it from all sorts of places. And let's look at the burning temperature, the melting point of steel. Stainless steel burns at and there's two columns. We'll use the Fahrenheit.
Okay, now what's the big deal about this, Joe? What's with the steel melting, burning?
Well, this is the thing that I was talking about with the blacksmithing. The Jew says that it couldn't happen because the fires weren't hot enough to melt the steel, to make the steel liquid. You know what I mean? And the other guy saying, which is the same thing I said to him, is it didn't have to melt it. It only had to heat it up to weaken it. And the fact that blacksmiths can... heat metal up and shape it with the power of their own hands in a hammer, tells you that heated steel under an extreme load would fail, and he won't acknowledge that.
Okay.
You get what I'm saying?
Which means Jew is saying that it had to be self-imploding, right? Like
it had to melt. Like the Jew's saying, because the fire wasn't hot enough to turn the steel to liquid, that means that it had to be imploded.
Okay. Right. It means it had to be set with explosives by the American people, yes, or whoever. Okay, all right, I got you now. Well, that's the first
time
I've
heard that. Or some fucking energy ray that dissolved the skeleton of the building or something.
Right, I'm going to go way forward and see how this ends so we can close this out.
Right, since the first one he was Fahrenheit. NIST blamed it on expansion of steel.
Explain that. Plus, we want a name off. We want a name, Debbie. A name. Who was behind it? A name. And why nobody has come forward to write a book and get the $1 billion or the $100 million or the...
I can stand by. Jew?
Am I unmuted?
You're muted. You're muted. That pissed me off when some mullet yells, shut up and let the men talk. I just find that so goddamn insulting and so bush league, so...
Like they would have in a blast furnace.
Well, it just seems like every word out of his mouth is about you. It's not about the subject.
No, because he doesn't know anything about it.
I don't disagree with you about Building 1 and 2. I totally agree with you.
300 feet away from the South
Tower. Oh, I think this is Pluto. Wait a minute.
300 feet. That's a sandwich. Okay? In golf jargon. 300 feet is nothing.
That's Falcon.
Well, it
was in the debris. Forget that the fire burnt for 12 hours before the building collapsed. Forget about that.
No,
the energy from the collapse itself and the percussionary energy from the collapse itself was enough to weaken that superstructure.
That's
and in the one eye, he won't give us one simple answer. He's the question man, all right? If you listen to him, it's all questions.
Well, you know what? Where's all the air coming from? I'm hearing...
It's me.
United 92, that traffic to 1 o'clock, 12 miles
eastbound, 370. Here's what it was. Some bimbat was over there in New York City. The thing happened. They called her on her cell phone. She was getting in her feet. She didn't know what the hell any buildings were.
Yeah. I'll tell you what.
Exactly the way I see it. Who's talking?
Hang on.
Because Dr. Pachenko said so.
Wait. February 26th of 1993, Ramzi Youssef and his bunch of little piss ants went.
Man, they had the big guns there tonight. That's Jerry. No, that's Joel. That's Joel. They had the big guns there, and I was going up against it. I started fighting them because they were ganging up on the Jew, and I said, I'm not defending the Jew. The Jew has enough to defend himself, but I'd be damned if I'm going to sit and let the Jew go up against five or six of you guys. This is bullshit, Snake, and you know it. So anyway, I don't know how it is. I'm going to go to the very end.
Tried to blow it up, the first conspiracy, and the other was not. You have
well, since
to decide.
Since you're telling us everything, why don't you just finish the
Over
story?
Over the same the kind of situation that drove us into what we're involved in today.
Oh,
so
I
make
see.
Up my mind.
I see.
And the Six-Day War was not a conspiracy.
No. I'll be the last person to ever try to blame a Jew for anything.
Well, right. And nobody in our room ever did, Bruce.
I don't know how it ended. I think it pretty much ended that they outsmarted him just because they had more people on their side. It was sort of like a panel against the Jew, and the Jews stayed pretty strong with him. But I think it was sort of just ended. I'll go to the very absolute end. Here we go.
Remember,
but he tried to turn it into a Jew situation.
One-eyed Jew.
Who's saying that? Identify.
Gentlemen, I'd like to thank this award on behalf of the Academy. Get the hell out of here.
This is the end of the road for the Jew.
You've done a great job of showing your anti-Semitism.
Yeah, they ended up just beating him. They hit him against the ropes. So I would say it was not fair, in my opinion. That's what I would say. Would you agree with that or no? So, anyway.
I don't know. It's pretty hard to feel sorry for a guy that begs for it.
Yeah, this is true. But now you see what I mean. Nobody likes him. Nobody. They just do not like him as a guy. I mean... It may sound weird, but they just don't.
I find them funny sometimes. I find that you can have a good conversation with them.
Oh, yeah.
But for whatever reason, he always has to have a pissing contest going, right?
Yes. Perfect.
Everybody's not always in that mood.
And people don't like that. He's like a prickly cactus. He's not a warm fuzzy, you know?
And then if you don't want to engage in it, it's like, well, they're scared of me. He's scared of me. She's scared of me. You know, everybody's scared of me.
And it's like, well, not true. It's not true. You can be not likable. And he is, in my opinion, not likable. He's a very prickly, cold cactus kind of person. So there you go.
Well, you know, it's just like fucking, you know, move on, man. Like fucking.
Yeah, true. So there you go. And he's really going to come at me now 1,000 times and all this kind of bullshit. He's going to say that I'm obsessed in playing his audio. And I was just doing it because I felt like I don't give a fuck. Thank you very much for that thing on interesting. Thank you very much, Sunny, on Skype on the secret chat room. And yeah. So thank you for calling, Joe. Love you. Right?
Yeah. Sounds great.
You are one of my favorites. You know that. Fuck you. You know I like you, Joe. I've always liked you.
That's why you're going to get rid of Beck and move to Canada.
Yeah, well, I'm working on it.
Well, I'm just telling you, you're getting behind in your housework around here.
I did enough housework today for everybody over at Heather's house.
Well, you're getting behind at this place, I'm telling you.
Oh, no. All right. Well, thank you for calling in. I'm just going to ease on down the road here, I guess. And gosh, this has been good to talk to you. Like a breath of fresh air. Jesus.
I'm going to eat some red grapes, I think.
You're positive and your spirit is always good. And I like people like that. I really feel that with you. I always have.
Well, you know, like everybody knows fat guys are jolly.
Oh, fuck off. Look like Shrek.
It's because we have our own boobs.
Bye, Joe.
Bye.
You gotta freaking love Joe Seeger. I mean, what? He's would be like the popular guy in the class. What's not to like? I mean, he's just got this vibe, this cool kind of vibe. And that's what I am drawn to. They say people are drawn to positive vibrations, positive energy. It's just like a battery or anything. And before I get off the air, I'm going to look up how a refrigerator works. What is that big deal about that? I will give you a link to the show that I was playing. If anybody's interested, you may not be interested, but here's the link to the show that I was playing right here. Hold One Eye Stabby. You probably remember that. You might have even been there, sweetie. There's the link to it if you want to watch it or listen to it. It's interesting. Yeah, you're right, Barco. It's rhetoric arguing. It's absolutely. It's 90% presentation. You're right. What is this skeptic.com? Whoa, slow down. The onistic finally met someone who argues more meta than he does. The metal of the plane was made of melts. Yeah, it's interesting. See, Barco says combustible paper did 9-1-1. Stabby says the burning of combustible items in the rooms also created the heat. True. That's very true. Barco says like using acetone torch to bend metal. Well, Barco or Stabby or Sunny or... Hi, Chris.
Hey, Debbie.
Hey, are you back on break?
Yeah, and I'm still awake.
Oh, no problem. Is the loony bin busy tonight? Many people coming in or what?
Oh, man, it's pretty chill. I really like night shift.
Really?
It is, yeah. I mean, it is so much more chill than day shift. And I'm getting used to this staying up all night thing. And
I love the night. I could always work the night. My father was a night owl. My brother's a night owl. I love the night.
Yeah.
So everybody's still saying that Hillary's going to win.
You're a little weird, but yeah.
They're saying that Hillary's going to win.
Who?
A lot of people tonight were saying that Hillary's still going to win.
Says who? The New York Times?
I don't know. No,
you know what?
What?
It's easy to think that because she's just like got so much crookedness and so much cheating and voter fraud and the whole entire media apparatus behind her. I mean, think about how much that translates in dollar amounts to campaign contributions, the way that NBC, ABC, CBS, CNN, some people on Fox News even, and all the major newspapers have just poured into trashing Trump.
I know.
All day, every day for the past 3 or 4 months.
Well, here's what I'm going to say. I'm going to move my microphone down here closer to me. I'm going to lay down. I'm actually laying down already. Here's the deal. I don't necessarily think about all of this, that, and the other, and blah, 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 blah. But here's my problem, guys. I don't feel safe with a commander-in-chief that will lie to us. And I do believe that the woman is capable of outright lying. And I don't trust liars. I just don't.
And I don't think the American people do either. And
I don't, Chris.
On election day are going to be pleasantly surprised when our country rejects Hillary Rotten Clinton.
Here's the deal. All I know is I'm for the alternative. If the alternative is Chris Nelson, I'm voting for Chris Nelson. If the alternative,
of course.
I mean, the alternative sucks. I know he's kind of racist. I don't.
No, that's not true, Devin.
Well,
hold on. Awesome.
I don't think that he is absolutely qualified to run this country.
He's not racist at all.
Right. I take that back. But here's the thing. It's the only alternative we have at this point.
You know, I would have said this. I remember when it was Romney 4 years ago, when it was John McCain 4 years before that. Uh-huh. And I was just like, okay, I'm going to hold my nose. I'm going to vote for the alternative because it's better than Obama. But this election season, I have gotten really excited about Trump. I went to one of his rallies. It was so packed. There were thousands of people there. And that's why I have hope that he's going to win, because his rallies have thousands and thousands of people. The line went the whole way around the ocean.
Chris, I do like his calm demeanor, the way he says, we're gonna take care of this. We're going to take care of the vets. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. And I feel like that he's the kind of person that has been in the hotel business, and he appreciates the waitress that carries 4 trays on one arm. And this is quoting somebody else. And he appreciates the working man, even though he may not be. He's been a part of what makes this country, which is, you know, a job, a business. And she's not. She's an elitist. She hasn't even driven a car.
She is a total elitist.
She's a part of the people that are against us, and she's going to try to do that same tax bullshit, and she is going to, and that is just, I mean, I'm okay, let's just say I like her. We'll just lie and say it's not a female thing that I don't do or whatever. I don't think she is going to take this country in a positive direction. I really don't.
Is she what you would describe as like your normal female, though? I mean, I don't see her as representing anything I find attractive in females at all. She's
no.
Gross.
And I believe that a woman who has allowed her husband to publicly humiliate like her, like she has in that office, what kind of respect can I, I can't respect her. If somebody came at me with hardcore 100% evidence that 10 years ago my husband had affairs behind my back, he'd be gone.
And in front of her. And that's why I believe fully she's a straight-up lesbian, because that's why Bill Clinton over the years was allowed by her to have all these mistresses. They had an arrangement. And Bill Clinton said it. Bill Clinton has said, quote, that Hillary eats more pussy than I do, you know?
I'm voting for Trump. She doesn't know it yet, but I'm voting for Trump.
Yeah, and that's why she has allowed him to have,
okay.
Because he's got to have sex somewhere. This is what okay. Everybody is sleeping with somebody, for the most part. I mean, Hillary Clinton is not sleeping in bed alone at night. She's having sex with somebody.
Right.
Hey, I gotta go.
All right, bye. And another thing is this. Okay, Benghazi. I think that wasn't handled right. And I don't believe the way that she lied about... Okay, the Clinton Foundation. Let's talk about that for a second. There was a leader in a country called, I want to say something like Turin or something like that, who donated wait a minute, let me think of what it was. I'll get it right. It was something like he wanted something. God, y'all going to make me get up. God dang it, because I want to get this right. But I don't want y'all to think that I'm just bullying her or I just don't like her because, yee-haw, I'm a gun-toting. It's not like that. I'm not even really for Trump. Chris, hold on. Are you there?
Hey, yeah, yeah. No, I just had a coworker come and tap on my window.
Oh, okay.
It's all good. Well, I've only been out here for a couple minutes.
Okay, what about the Clinton Foundation, the way she would go over to these heads of state in all these countries that weren't our allies, and she would do things with the State Department, and she would let Bill Clinton make a speech for $700. I mean, who makes $6.2 million on speeches?
For one speech. I mean, and all this money comes from these countries that are, like, oppressive Muslim regimes, like Qatar and Saudi Arabia, but in the end, you know, Donald Trump is a hero of the working class, and he is not a politician, and he is going to go in there and he's going to straighten things out.
But the group, and the Illuminati, the elitists don't want the country straightened out because that's what Kennedy. That's what that's what Kennedy was going to do, because they're going to all lose all their control of this people.
They don't want to lose control. Their dream is to have this. It's what almost every other country has, this upper elite making all the decisions, which we kind of have now in this country with the Supreme Court. I mean, it's not, you know, when a panel of nine judges decide what's the law of the land is going to be. I mean, that's not democracy or a republic or anything. But
right.
And they voted themselves that power.
I know. I know.
In Marbury versus Madison, they voted themselves that power of judicial review.
I'm very familiar with that.
I have faith in this country that this country is going to come out massively and elect Donald Trump. And, I mean, just think about how much, I mean, it'll be great to feel great about America again.
It'll feel like we can sleep at night again. Somebody's up there, they're just going to say, okay, guys, look, let's have a meeting. Okay, the vets. We got vets killing each other. They're committing suicide at the rate of 22 a day. We got to fix that. What can we do? We need to come up with a plan. And that's what I think that he's going to do. He's going to go in there like you or I would and just fix all this crazy shit.
Yes.
And she's not. She's going to leave the IRS in power like they are, dirty and rotten like they are, the CIA in power. She uses those two tools to crush anybody that she wants. And she's going to continue. I mean, if you think that she could get pay for play and have a piggy bank going on when she was Secretary of State, what the hell can she do as the president?
Yes. I know. And
she will become a multi-billionaire.
Oh, she already is.
Well, she'll get richer.
She is outspending Trump so much through her pack there. You should see the amount of anti-Trump commercials that are running down here. The, what's it called? The Think Progress Forward pack or whatever they're called. That,
I know what you're talking about. I know what you're talking about. I know exactly what you're talking about.
But I love, the anti-Trump ads, because they make me like him even more. You can tell them to go fuck themselves.
I think that's hilarious. Well,
we need somebody funny.
He looks like to me a guy that most of you guys would play golf with.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? By the way, I want to ask you something completely off topic. There was a mother in, where do you live again?
Daytona Beach,
that had three children in a minivan, or a whatever you call it, a minivan.
That's right, in the ocean.
What the fuck?
I know. I mean, well, down here, you can drive your car right up on the beach.
Right.
Down here. And park your car on the beach. And this mother, she just went berserk. And she tried to drown her three kids. She put them in a van and then just drove it into the ocean.
Mm-mm-mm. Whatever happened to her? Do you know?
I think she's behind bars, but wow. She probably got off with a psych defense. She'll probably be out doing it again in a couple years.
Man, you're going back in the hospital, aren't you?
Got to get back to work, Debbie.
All right. I'll talk to you again, Chris. Right, bye. You know, I'm going to take my time and do this. Hold on. Let me sit back up. Hold on. I got to get up. I'm laying down on the floor because I love a hard surface to sleep on. I love Joe Seeker. God damn it. I love Joe. Hold on. I got to get up. Oh, okay. All right. I'm back up. I want to play this for y'all before I leave. Okay. I mean, before I did my show yesterday on YouTube. I only do Monday through Friday and I got great response on it. Hold on. I just threw that out there for hush, foo foo. We're fixing to go out right now. Hey, Ned, what's going on? Don't say hi to Stabby. He's mean. Don't talk to Stabby. Don't sit by Stabby. Get away. Hi, Ned. What's going on, crazy lady? I went to the fair. Anyway, let me show y'all this one thing if I can find it. It's going to be on my history on YouTube. And I want y'all to hear what this guy has to say. And he made so much sense. Annette, Dano died. Can you believe that? Yeah, just by the way. Anyway, Dano died. Let me go back and find where it is. When Trumpets Fade. Show full history. No, not full history. Go to YouTube and get that history. Hold on just a second. Y'all stand by. History. All right. I want y'all to hear this because this guy made, he put it ways I wish I could. And he is right. Where are you, guy, that put it so kindly? Hold on. Where is it? There's the IKEA. Don't buy IKEA furniture. It kills kids. Benny and the Jets. Where is it? Now you, I won't be able to find it. Hold on. Gosh, dog it. It's not on my history. You know why it's not on your history? Because if you go on your history on you, wait a minute. Maybe this is it. It'll only show, well, never mind. Shut up. Hold on. I have to go to my real history, which is here. Hold on. I'm looking. Hold on just a second. That's when I was looking at my grandparents' old farmhouse on Google Maps. I love maps for some reason. I mean, I can do this. All right, here we go. All right. I believe it is. I've got it now. I just got to find which one it is. I think. Oh, I could be wrong. I think it was on this one. I hope it's this one. Crap. Let me see if it's this one. If it's not, I'll let y'all off the hook. Crap, which one is it? I'm sorry. Hold on. I'm just babbling. Where did he go? Damn it. All right, this just came out 53 minutes ago while we've been on the air. This is breaking news.
Has troubled me deeply. I do not think we should have pushed for an election in the Palestinian territories. I think that was a big mistake.
It says, leaked Clinton audio. Clinton aims to rig the Palestinian election. I'm going to back that up and let y'all hear. It's only 31 seconds long. This just came out. This came out 50 minutes ago.
Troubled me deeply. I do not think we should have pushed for an election in the Palestinian territories. I think that was a big mistake. And if we were going to push for an election, then we should have made sure that we did something to determine who was going to win.
All right. That just came out. And I'm on their website. I mean, it's a website. This just came out 58 minutes ago.
But I don't know where this email, where these emails came from. What apparently Anthony Weiner. Well, oh God.
Oh. All right. I'm on a guy's website. Where is that guy? Damn it. Hold on. I'll find it. This just came out 59 minutes ago. That's nothing new, though. damn it. Oh, I'm so mad. Hold on. Oh, wait. I know what it was. Okay, hold on. It was... What's her face? God damn it. I'm so bad with names. The blonde-headed chick that's so hot on Fox. Kelly. Megyn Kelly. Hold on just a second. Megyn Kelly interviewed... Well, hold on. We'll just find it. I wouldn't be making a big deal out of it if it wasn't this important. And no, it's not Newt Gingrich. It was... Crap, crap, crap. It was... Maybe I can't find it. Found it, found it, found it, found it, found it. All right, ready? I want y'all to listen to this. Listen to what this gentleman says. I don't want to say his name because well, he's all stupid. His name is Huckabee, okay? And I think, hold on, here we go. Just listen.
We're going to win Florida, too. We're going to win Ohio, and we're going to win Iowa. Yeah, we're winning a lot of states.
Chief political correspondent Carl Cameron reports tonight from that last rally. Carl?
Thanks, Megan. It's clear as we head into the final stretch, the pace of the race is accelerating a tremendous amount. More events, a lot more polls, and more controversy today.
Presidential candidate, not a wimp, nor a wuss. Governor Mike Huckabee, great to see you, Gov. So let's just start with someone, wimp, wuss, or something else. Jason Chaffetz, who... After that Access Hollywood tape broke, came out and said, I'm done, and withdrew his endorsement of Donald Trump. And yet, tonight, he tweeted out, I will not defend or endorse Donald Trump, but I am voting for him. Hillary Clinton is that bad.
Well, she is that bad. I mean, what we've learned
but what,
and what
how do
even
you read
your
him?
Earlier
what,
guests
what is
talked
he?
About.
Is he a wimp? Is he a wuss? What is he? So he's withdrawing the endorsement.
He's beginning to gain a little spine. The fact that he's at least going to vote right. Look, any Republican, anybody who understands how corrupt the Clintons are, who gets it, that she is surrounded by people who have never told her no. She sets up a private email server. She lies to Congress. She destroys evidence that's under subpoena. She treats foreign governments like they're a piggy bank for the Clinton Foundation to make her family rich. She violates the law whenever she wants to. She knows she's not going to get caught. She uses the government agencies like the FBI and the IRS like her own personal toys to go after political opponents. Good gosh, Megan, is there any Republican who has breath left who could stand back and let that happen without doing everything they can to stop it? And the only roadblock in the way to that level of corruption that would forever taint our government is Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. Like him or not, he's the shot we've got, and we'd better get behind him with energy.
Well,
there. That's what I want to say to y'all. She's done this, she's done that, and these are facts. These aren't... rumors. I mean, this has all been proven, okay? She lied about all of it, but it has all been proven, okay? And then he said the only roadblock we have to this is Donald Trump. Like him or not, he's our bell cow, okay? That's my stance. And even though I may not have worded it right or whatever, I mean, I don't claim to be a big political analyst. You know I'm not. I've never done this before, but I just had to get in on this deal. I don't particularly have a dog in the fight. I don't particularly love Donald Trump, but I just would... Let me let the rest of this play, all right? And y'all tell me what y'all think. I don't want to go over there right now because I'll just get upset at what's being said, but here we go. I like Joe because he keeps things simple. He's honest. Anyway, here we go.
Well, that's the question, you know, is do they like him better than they like her? They don't seem to like either one of them.
They better.
You know,
they don't. Better.
But let me ask you whether you think Trump is doing what he ought to be doing these last 13 days. He came under some fire today for being at the opening of the old post office, a building, you know, he's put a lot of money into and a lot of work into. And he was like, hey, I deserve a day to go. But he came under significant criticism for wasting half a day in we only have 13 days left. Do you agree?
You know, it's nonsense. If Donald Trump had gone into some type of cathedral to pray, laid on his face and prayed out loud to God for 2 hours, the people would have said he was wasting his time because God wouldn't hear him. Look, these people who are criticizing him for opening his hotel are nonsense. Let me tell you what that hotel represents. It's about the only thing in Washington, D.C. that actually works. It's one of the few things in that city that was ever brought in under budget and on time. Nothing else in that town works. If nothing else, it's a great way for Donald Trump to say, just like I built this hotel, that's how I'm going to lead this country because I know how things are supposed to work.
That's another point that I've tried to make. I don't know what he's going to do. I don't know if he's going to be able to do it. But I do know that he is going to try to help straighten some of this crap out. And she's not. She just makes empty promises. Guys, look, okay, let me explain something to you. This is my opinion because this is my stupid show, okay? I don't trust somebody that lies. Now, I can understand little white lies. Like, hey, Debbie, what size is your dress? Oh, I bought a 6. Okay, knowing I bought an 8. That's not going to hurt anybody. I'm talking about a lie that will destroy another person. A lie telling somebody that you try to do something to them, or just an outright slanderous lie, or a lie that will hurt people, okay? Telling somebody that I have a size 5 on instead of a 7, you know what I'm saying? Everybody does that. So I agree with you. Yes, Debbie, everybody tells lies. Wait a minute, we haven't heard from my schizophrenic voice. Debbie? Ugh. I thought I'd go all night without talking to you. You know, I kind of like the Joe guy too, but we have to kill him. Kill him? Yeah, we got to kill Joe. Oh my God. Go away, schizophrenic voice. Debbie, you keep talking to me like that and I'm going to kill you. Oh, kill Annette too. We're going to spare Stabby though. I like him. Anyway, what I'm trying to say is this, all right? I was raised how I was raised. I didn't have a choice. I didn't have a choice the family I got. I was dealt a hand that I played as well as I could. And the main thing that my father put into my hard drive, put into my C drive, put into my configuration system was honesty. Honesty. He would say right here and point to his eyes, and I had to look him in the eye and tell him either where I was, what I'd. And so I became at a very early age fearful of lying. And it is an obsession with me. It's an obsession with my kids. It's an obsession with my dog. No, I'm joking. What? Debbie, I forgot to tell you, we need an off gun or two. I'm thinking maybe getting him ran over. Go away, schizophrenic voice. Anyway, I'm doing that because there's an idiot on Spreaker trying to tell people that I'm schizophrenic. What the fuck? The bottom line is this. I believe, this is the way I was raised, I believe that you are capable of doing certain things in your life. And this is the truth if you think about it. You'll either take a hit of acid, or you won't take a hit of acid. Joe said he would. I said I wouldn't. You will either steal from somebody that you know if they're not looking, or you won't. Most people live their life by making choices. You either will or you won't, okay? I believe that there are people that have the capacity to lie. They don't have a problem with it. Their inner judgment and their moral compass just doesn't point straight like other people's do, okay? I do not feel, with every cell in my body, that Hillary Clinton is an honest person. And I cannot, for the life of me, feel comfortable knowing that she is running the free world. And I cannot respect anybody that tells me that they trust her, knowing what I have given you the past 6 months to 7 to 8 months on this program about her. I've brought you audio from the Senate hearings, from Congress, from people that know her, from people that have researched her. We went through the Clinton Chronicles. We've talked about it all. And it is my opinion that anybody out there that is continuing to this date to support anything that has to do with that woman, you've got to have something wrong. You've got to be either, I don't know what it is. And again, I am not going Trump. I don't even have a Trump sticker on my car. I've never bought a Trump, anything Trump. I have nothing. Because I'm not so much pro-Trump. But again, just like Governor Huckabee said, he is the only roadblock we have to stopping this madness. And until you get, and I'm not into the Illuminati. I mean, I think Victor's all the way down the rabbit hole, if you ask me. But whatever. But what I'm saying is, please believe me when I say this. And if I never speak to you again, if I hang up and turn around and I get hit by a bus inside my car, or if Gunner decides to kill me, whatever. That's all I've tried to tell you. And I guess I'm mostly talking to Stabby, because I adore Stabby. Stabby's been with me a long time. It's almost like Stabby is a part of my show. I mean, he's been with me forever. And I don't want Stabby to let this, I know his real name, but his name is Stabby, okay? I don't want him to let this election crap come in between our online, distant, troubling relationship. I've never tried to say anything other than just what I know to be true about this woman, and she scares me. She does. She scares me. She sat there in front of the United States, and she lied yesterday. She said, well, I don't believe he only sent that email. All I'm trying to say is this. I know certain things to be true. I know Joe makes me laugh. I don't care what Joe is or Joe did or Joe had or Joe says or Joe this. Joe makes me laugh, and I love that, okay? He seems to be honest. If I ask him a question, he says, I don't know. He's funny. Stabby's been with me a long time. Maybe since the beginning. And you know, I was thinking the other day, I really haven't been doing this that long. If you go back and say, I started in 2010, it's only been 6 years. And it's kind of on and off since then. I mean, I got kicked off in 2010. I got kicked off the internet practically by the BWC for life. Anyway, that's all I'm really trying to say to you guys. And Huckabee hit me today when I heard him say it, Governor Huckabee, excuse me. He put it like I would love to be able to put it. You know what I'm saying? Does that make any goddamn sense? Is Stabby just saying I'm a stupid idiot? Jewish producer, don't eat those burritos. Those are nasty. Those ones that you buy that are by Amy's. Don't do that. Those are bad. Come over here and I'll give you some food I had for dinner. Fuck, I forgot to put that food up. That's all I'm trying to say. That's all I've done. That's it. I'm just trying to show what I know to be something that I believe could be dangerous. That's all I'm saying. Just throwing it out there. Steve Nice goes, I'm just throwing it out there. So yeah, that's it. That is my, I have on overalls. Can you hear my clicker? That's my, I only do one side. I only do the left side. The right side hangs down. And they're huge. They're like the biggest ones I could possibly find. But that's what I like wearing on my person. Yeah. But that's it. Squeak, squeak, squeak. That is my mouse. I know it's bothering you all, and I hate it too, but it's all we have. People wonder why I always do this. Well, it's because, excuse me, I've lost a lot of people to death. And I believe that this song says, in my opinion, the reason I like this because it closes me out on a real solemn kind of a, because sometimes things can get a little heated around here, you know what I'm saying? And it kind of just brings me down and kind of centers me a little bit, but you know why, fuck you. All right, next time, guys, bye.
If you had not have fallen, then I would not have found you. Angel flying too close to the ground. And I patched up your broken wing. Hung around a while, trying to keep your spirits up. And your fever down. I knew someday love to be found. So leave me if you need to. I will still remember angel flying.
Your word. You lose your honor. There is nothing that will impact your life more than that. Ever. Ever. I will not return to him and have him say, hang on just a second. I sent you down at a specific time, did I not? Yes, you did. And this is an eternal plan, right? Yes, you weren't born for happenstance. It just didn't happen that you popped out in America at this time, right? No, Lord. I know there is a plan to everything you do. Okay, so I set you in America at its time of crisis. I gave you parents who taught you my words. They filled it. You even went to one of the best universities based on my word. And help me out again. You did what? Because I'm just looking here and I know what it says because I wrote it. So I know what it says, but help me out. What part of stay away from men like that? What part of, Lord, we had the Supreme Court. Quote, this because I played this out in my head. What am I going to say to him? You don't understand? You weren't there? We had no other choice? Yes, you do.
Typing in the chat room. That was brought to us by Stabby. All right, that's it. Bye, guys.